Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. We've received apologies from Mark Griffin, MSP, and Marie McNair. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you, we're all agreed. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence from three panels of witnesses on pre-budget scrutiny. And we're joined in the room on our first panel by Sean Bailey from GMB Scotland. I've got to get this right now. Linda Somerville, Deputy General Secretary of Scottish Trades Union Congress. And we are joined online by Joanna Baxter, who's the head of local government at Unison. And we were due to hear from Graham McNab, who's the local government officer at Unite, but unfortunately he's been unable to join us. So we're now going to turn to questions from members, and we'll try to direct our questions to specific witnesses initially where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks, or if you're joining online, as you are, Joanna, put an R in the chat function. So I think I've kind of got a broad opening question, and maybe Linda, I'll direct it to you initially. And I'd be interested to hear if you could highlight the main challenge that you believe local government workforce is currently facing.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I just want to say thanks for having us along today. I think it's increasing importance that trade union representatives are given evidence either at committee or in given other opportunities to do so on behalf of the workforce. So thank you for doing that. It's really important to share workforce experiences. The Audit Commission report that you've had in front of you, and I know that that's prompted some of your discussion, looks rather starkly with its opening line around councils and communities face a stark future. And that's quite a grim opening statement. But in some ways, I think it's actually more realistic reflection on local government and where it's at the moment than potentially some of the other, you know, narrative that we hear from Scottish Government or elsewhere. I mean, we think there's been a consistent underfunding of local government, and we would agree with the estimates that were made, I think, last year after the budget between COSLA and the public finance directors of the around about £1 billion shortfall in local government. The impact of that underfunding we can see in our communities, we can see it in staff shortages across local authorities. I mean, everyone probably here has had some dealings with local authorities in the last, 6 months or so. I mean, we're still coming out of a COVID backlog. I wouldn't say that we're certainly post-COVID in terms of the medical situation, but the COVID backlog that there is from local authorities has not gone away. That is very, very evident in the workforce and what's been going on. We see services closing, where some local authorities are choosing to close services, and the impact that's having on our communities. And I know it's really important to the committee and indeed to local government generally to say, how do we service our communities best? It's what public services are there to do. Scottish Government have made it a priority. Again, we welcome that in programme for government, that they want to make the efficient and effective public services a huge priority. And that's obviously reflected in the New Deal as well. But we think that there is a struggle to do that because it runs counter to actually what's happening on the ground, where the workforce can see the implications that there are long term now of underfunding, where people are asked consistently to do more with less. So the work hasn't gone away. The work may have changed in some areas. There are some areas where that have done things differently since COVID, and that's been successful. But all too often, the work hasn't gone away. In local authorities, some of the work can't be turned into, you know, there's no technical solution for it. A lot of it is people-centred work. So therefore, it still needs workers to do that. So we've got a history, I think, of underfunding, and we're now at a situation where I don't think it is unrealistic to talk about a crisis in local government. And in terms of the workforce, we see low morale, we see the impact there's been of industrial action over a number of years, where workers are trying to get a decent pay rise against rising costs. And again, unfortunately, we look like we're heading in that direction again this year. I know the former Deputy First Minister, after some of the discussions he'd had with both COSLA and trade unions last year, had looked to say that we need to learn some lessons from what's happened around industrial action and industrial relations really across the local authorities. And I'm not sure that we've got to that place, which is a bit unfortunate. So it's not the best you know, outcome really at the moment for the workforce and for those that are there and are very much committed to and trying to deliver good public services.
Thanks very much for that. So Linda gave us a very comprehensive response, but if Sean or Joanna, if you want to add anything, you're welcome to come in. Joanna.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I would just add to the contribution that Linda has made by saying I think the dispute, the industrial dispute that we have with Korsla at the moment is reflective of that decade of underfunding of local government, because the pressure that workers are experiencing in terms of the work they're being asked to do, as Linda has said, jobs have been cut during the last decade, but none of the work has reduced. So we are seeing members under enormous pressure from stress, both of the physical and emotional demands of trying to deliver high quality services without the adequate resources to do that. And I think last year's Scottish Government spending review indicated that the overall pay bill should be frozen and reducing the public sector workforce to pre-pandemic levels, which would amount to a loss of 30,000 public sector jobs, against a background in which 9 out of 10 jobs that were lost during the period of austerity were lost in local government. So I think that the current dispute that we are in with Korsla over pay, you will be aware that there is looming industrial action on the 26th, 7th and 8th of September. I believe that the industrial action ballot results that we have seen, certainly in unison, are reflective of that level of concern amongst the workforce, both in terms of pay, but also the resourcing of their jobs. And I think it's untenable, really, for that overall pay bill to remain frozen. There does need to be a recognition of the enormous contribution that this workforce makes. And I would just say that the ballot results that we saw, where we have a strike mandate covering over 21,000 members across 24 local authority areas and almost 2,000 schools, is absolutely unprecedented, and I think demonstrates that feeling of concern and anger amongst the local government workforce.
Thanks very much for that response. Sean, do you want to come in with anything?
Aye, just quickly. Yeah. Possible. So I think just to reiterate some of the points my colleagues have made, underfunding is undoubtedly the largest obstacle to local government at the minute, or the biggest issue, both in terms of service delivery, but also in maintaining a happy and productive workforce. And as Joanna says, you've got looming strikes over pay, but as we've maintained over the previous few years, happy workers do not vote for strike action. Happy workers do not take strike action. So it's not just about pay, it's all these underlying issues. And we've seen for a long, long time the mental and physical impact that cuts have had. So everything we're seeing at the minute is, unfortunately, in my opinion, a consequence of the last 10 to 15 years of cuts. There's no getting away from that. And I'm sure we'll get into more detail on some of those points later on.
Great. Thank you very much for that. John, I'm going to come to you with the next question. Kind of layering on from hearing about the challenges, and thanks for flagging up the current dispute. So you're aware that we've got the New Deal for local government, the New Deal with local government, and that's the Scottish Government and COSLA are currently working on the details of that. And I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on what the key ways this New Deal could support local authorities in addressing the challenges that they're facing in terms of workforce?
Thank you for that. That's a very good question. I think in unison, we were very interested to see the announcement of the New Deal, the Verity House Agreement. And our response at the time remains as it is today, which is that the Verity House Agreement says many good things, but it contains no additional investment for local government. It indicates that local authorities will have greater fiscal flexibilities, and that's welcome. But there is only so far that that will get them. And I have to say, unfortunately, given the current dispute that we are in with COSLA, we have seen very little impact of this new deal in terms of the discourse that we are having with COSLA. And if anything, actually, I would say that it is being used as a reason why one side can't take on the other. So we approach COSLA and say, you know, if you don't have enough money to fund a decent pay offer, then why aren't you speaking to the Scottish Government to get the additional funding that you require to provide a decent pay offer? They say, we have very constructive relations with Scottish Government and therefore they couldn't possibly criticise them. We ask Scottish Government why they're not speaking to COSLA about the additional funding they would require to make a decent pay offer. They say at Berry's House Agreement, we can't possibly interfere in COSLA's relationship with the trade union. So, far from being the solution that I think everybody would wish it to be, I don't believe the Verity House agreement has to date delivered any real positive or tangible benefits that the workforce might see the benefit from. So I think there needs to be there needs to be a grown-up and honest conversation about the financial resources that local government needs to deliver the services that we all rely upon. And I would just cite some of the previous winter crises that we've experienced. Local government are the people that deliver preventative services that support the health service. You cannot only address things like the winter crisis or indeed emergencies like COVID by investing in the NHS. You also have to invest in the preventative services that our members deliver day in, day out.
Thanks for that. Could you just unpack what you mean by the preventative services, just so we've got that on the record? So the kinds of preventative services local government delivers.
Yes. So in terms of supporting people in their own homes, social care at home services, but also, frankly, I think things like refuse collection, which is something that people take for granted sometimes. But I would say if you have rubbish piling up on the streets, it won't be long before you have health issues or concerns of a different nature. I would go back to also the sorts of discussions that we were having with both COSLA and the Scottish Government during the COVID pandemic, where our members who dig graves were integral to ensuring that bodies weren't piling up. So there is a massive diversity of roles within local government, which seem to get very little attention paid to them, but which are actually crucial in terms of providing services that we all rely upon. And then I would just also say as well, the people that are covered by our strike mandate, those who work in schools to support the education of our children, also support key workers by providing early years services as well to allow those key workers to get to work. We saw that during the pandemic. So there's a massive... there's a massive role for local government in the provision of preventative services, and I think we need to consider that in much greater detail when we look at investment into health education, for example, and ensure that local government get the financial resources that's necessary to actually provide those services.
Thanks very much. Much for going into that detail. Sean or Linda, do you want to add anything to the question around the New Deal?
the New Deal, I mean, we have similar concerns. You know, we welcome the changes that it brought in about ring fencing and giving local authorities more devolved powers, as they should have, well, you know, reinstating really their devolved power to use their budgets as they see fit, because, you know, local authorities are, by the very nature of whether they're a rural community or an urban community, they have all different challenges and one size does not fit all. So we welcome that, but, you know, any analysis of it shows, and you've said that the government are working on the detail of it, but we've still to see any of that. It's really a glossy memorandum of understanding between two organisations, and that's welcome, because when, you know, they do have to have good engagement, they do have to sit down and speak both formally and informally, and the agreement allows for that, so that's helpful. But in terms of how it's actually going to pan out for the workforce, we can't see at the moment that that's actually going to deliver, because whilst there's a commitment to have regular reviews of funding, there is no method to say how that will be done. Is that outside of the budget timescale? Is that alongside the budget? Is it at a different time? What is that process? You know, so we don't have any detail about how that will work. The thing about preventative spend as well, whether you're looking at social work, where there's a lot of preventative spend, you know, in our communities through with criminal justice, with youth offending, whether it's through working with families and those are people that are vulnerable in our communities. There's lots of preventative spending there as well. And it's another area that's often not really highlighted about, you know, the benefit that that has and how local authorities, some of it is statutory provision, but a lot of it isn't, and how local authorities are having to strip back these things unless it is absolutely statutory provision. And tackling poverty, not just child poverty, but now tackling poverty is, you know, overall for families and for individuals, is government's priority. And yet this, the lack of provision there is for preventative services and those that are not statutory in local authorities because of their funding constraints means that that's working against Scottish Government's actual priorities.
Thanks for that. Sean, do you want to add in? Okay. I'm going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone on this wet, miserable day in Edinburgh. Linda, you opened up with some comments about the budget allocations that are quite important to hear and to get on the record. And you mentioned the £1 billion shortfall that's been mentioned several times at this committee in the past. If you have a look at the finance circular that accompanies the provisional budget, it shows a 1.3% real terms increase from last year to this, and if you look over the last 10 years, that provisional revenue settlement is actually a 4.3% real terms increase. Just can you explain to us why there's such a divide between your own estimate of what the situation is and the figures that are in things like the finance circles? How do we get such different figures, do you think?
I mean, that wasn't my estimate. I was simply quoting what was both COSLA's and the Chartered Institute of Public Finance Administrators, the estimate that they came up with. But it's not something that we would disagree with. You know, we don't have the calculation for what the shortfall is, but, you know, we certainly, that's the information that we have is what from workforces as to what they see. I think one of the things to look at as well is, has service provision changed over that period? So whilst you may look at, is it a static budget or is it an increasing budget? What is the absolute, what can you buy with that? What can be done with that budget? And that's maybe where some of the problem is. You've got a changing demographic in terms of our communities. We've got an ageing population. We have people that are living longer, but not always living well. And so these are things that local government are having to deal with. And we also have housing crisis where we've got a lack of housing and affordable housing. Local government are having to deal with a lack of capital budget sometimes to actually maintain what they've already got. So I think that sometimes the issues around how budget calculations are done by different organisations are also around saying what needs done with that budget and how do we take that forward.
It's more of an expression of what we think we need to do to serve our communities better. And that seems to explain the disparity in the figures that we see quoted in front of us, I think, from time to time.
Sometimes there's a lack of ambition about it as well. Okay. I think where, you know, often some of the budget figures that the local government themselves might look at is say, what do we need done to provide the services that we've already got? And I think, you know, when Scottish Government are looking at their budget, and this is obviously part of the process for that, we need to think about what is the ambition we have and what's the vision we have for local government? You know, what do we want our services to look like in a community that is really flourishing? not just existing, not just surviving or getting by. So, you know, there's something there about any figures that we come across generally are what we need to plug the hole, to plug the gap that's there, not to think about what we could have if we actually made the best of our communities and allowed them to flourish. Because poverty isn't just about money in people's pockets. Poverty is also about people having access to culture, libraries, you know, all the things that they need. So I think there's a much wider ambition there that we really should sometimes talk about.
That's good to hear that. Thanks very much for adding that. I just wanted to ask a question about issues about workforce. And I note that our predecessor committee, way back in 2018, it noted that our local authority workforces don't tend to reflect the communities they serve. So a question that arose from that was, what can we do to make our workforces more representative of the local communities? And they were particularly highlighting those in senior positions as if there was a disparity there between the type of workforce we have within local government and the communities that are served. Is that something that any of our three colleagues recognise from that time, that previous committee's report? And do you think we've made any progress on that to date?
I'm just going to say I can speak briefly on it and then let my colleagues come in. But I think, you know, really what we're talking about there is a lack of diversity in some parts of our workforce, particularly the gender pay gap will feed into that when you're looking at early years provision and social care. So any caring parts of the workforce, you will find that there's a gender pay gap, which therefore means it's less attractive. And there are other reasons as well, but less attractive for men to join that workforce. So there are some issues there around pay that you probably need to look at in order to address that. But occupational segregation, whether it's horizontal or vertical occupational segregation, exists throughout most workforces. It's a persistent problem across most of Western Europe, not in other parts of the world, and exists for deep-rooted, long-term issues around, structural inequalities, really. So, but there are things I think employers can do. Looking at quality part-time work is one of the things that can be done. And I think when you look at women moving into leadership positions or senior positions, quality part-time work is something that isn't always looked at. Job construction, when you actually put new jobs together, do they have to be full-time? Quality part-time work is something that is often seen as undervalued. Women will talk about, I just work part-time. And immediately, therefore, it actually denies the quality of the work that they do in the time that they are there. And also women tend to find that they negotiate themselves into flexible working. And when they're in a job, they negotiate the hours that suit them, and then they never change out of that job because they can never think that they'll get the same deal somewhere else. So there's a whole things that can be done that employers can take forward, and local government is no different. In fact, local government should actually be outstanding in this because it has a much wider remit for doing those type of employment practices. I think employers sometimes are a bit frightened as well that they get it wrong. So sometimes they want to take positive action to address an imbalance in the workforce. That could be around making sure that they target the BME community. But they don't want to do anything because they think they're worried they'll get it wrong. So I think there needs to be a bit of confidence built within employee relations. And indeed, sometimes local government, like other organisations, have devolved HR practice down to local managers with very, very little training. So I think there needs to be a bit more confidence and training there so that people can actually take positive action, which is legal for them to do, not positive discrimination, but positive action to actually diversify their workforce.
Thanks for that, Linda. I wonder if I could invite Sean and Joanna maybe to comment on the previous committee's comments about the local authority workforce not being particularly representative of the communities that they have. Is that something that you recognise yourselves, and is there something we can do to improve that? And then I can move on to another question.
Well, if I could just go on. I think that if you look at local government as a whole, then we talk about underfunding, so the staffing levels have reduced overall, and they shrink year on year through cuts, redundancy packages, etc., etc. You aren't recruiting anybody new into that, so you're not recruiting a more diverse pool of staff that enables them to come into the organisation. So if you're an organisation that's shrinking, you're never going to be able to have a positive intervention on the makeup of the demographics within that staffing pool. So it shrinks, you're going to keep holding on to people. Any progression through that is going to be the same people that are progressing. You're not bringing anybody new into the organisation, and it just becomes a death spiral. I'm sure it's a phrase I'll repeat probably today, maybe over-egging it, but that's my experience.
Joanna?
Thank you, Convener. A number of things that I would say on this. So I would agree with Sean that if you are looking at a shrinking workforce, your ability to secure increased diversity in that workforce becomes much more difficult. If we look at areas like social care, for example, the last sets of data in terms of vacancy rates within social care that the SSSC published demonstrate that, for example, East Dumbartonshire, as of December 2022, had 60% vacancies. Edinburgh had 59% vacancies in their services. Dundee, Clackmannanshire, North Lanarkshire all had 57% vacancies within their services. So there is a real issue about attracting people to work in local government. I mean, very clearly, our view is that central to that is pay. I go back to the fact that we are in dispute at the moment on pay. We were last year as well, though. So it doesn't seem like local authorities and the Scottish Government have learned the lessons about pay disputes and perhaps why so many of the workforce are willing to take industrial action to secure better pay deals. I would just say that this does also affect positions at a more senior level. Whilst all three trade unions have sought to ensure that the lowest paid within local government are protected in our pay negotiations, we've experienced a real squeeze in those members who are employed in middle-income brackets. There's been a very difficult balance for us to strike between trying to ensure that those on the lowest pay get decent uplifts, but also protecting those in middle-income bands. And I would just also say that in terms of the discussions that we've had with COSLA about trying to bring the workforce up to a minimum of £15 an hour within a reasonable time period, we would say within the space of 3 years. What they say to us is we just can't afford it. So you then see workers leaving local government to go and work either for the private sector or other areas of the public sector because they would secure higher wages in doing so. So we continue the trend of a shrinking workforce and increased pressure on those who remain. And I think the other thing that I'd add to that is just to say that the whole focus on pay and funding means that actually everybody in local government is firefighting all the time. And we don't get the opportunity that any of us would like to spend on some of the other conversations that we would like to have about diversity, about, for example, greater flexibility in the working week, reduction of the working week without detriment, the use of new technologies, for example.
OK, thank you very much for that, Joanna. I wonder if I could ask a follow-up question, Convener. Just touching on inequalities, Linda, you introduced some ideas about the problems that we face there. I mean, we know that APSE's local government report highlighted that most local authority staff are women. We all kind of knew that anyway, but we know that there are still inequalities in pay and progression and gendered segregation of occupations. There's problems there. And you offered a few suggestions about how we might overcome this, Linda, in some of the comments that you'd made earlier. Could you invite our three colleagues to expand on that? And what are we actually doing to address these continuing inequalities, particularly to women?
I mean, I don't know the specifics of what local government are doing. I'm speaking much more generally about employers generally, but I mean, my colleagues might know if there's any initiatives within local government. But I think it's worth reflecting on Joanna's point that, you know, when organisations are firefighting around trying to keep services going, often it is equalities that is put to the side. because people say, well, we've not got time for that, we can't invest in that just now. Or it's done in a way which is sometimes I've seen with employers, it's done in a way which is seemingly tokenistic, because you actually need to take time and to change a lot of systems. You know, you need to think about unconscious bias training, you need to think about who recruits, how they recruit, how people are promoted, what are the systems in place, what networks exist within a workplace, are they formal or informal networks, do you actually have to put in place formal networks for women, for LGBT workers, for example, you know, so that they can actually have a space that can support them in the way that in other parts of the workforce are supported. So there's lots of things that employers can do, but, you know, I completely agree that, you know, when people are firefighting and trying to provide services, then it's sometimes not the top of the agenda. I see my colleagues might know more about what specifically local government employers are doing at the moment about it.
OK. Sean?
Just very quickly, again, coming back to pay, I suppose. Next week, as Joanna said, we've got thousands of school staff, excluding teachers, who are going to take industrial action over this year's pay this year and this year's pay award. And this year's pay award still fails to match the offer that was given to English workers who work for England and Wales councils, to the tune of at least £500. That's more if it's prorated for part-time, which majority of these school workers do work part-time. They're not full 37-hour weeks. So if we want to talk about how we can, particularly around pay equality, there's a great first step there that can be easily resolved within the next week, is to at least match that pay offer that England and Wales got for this financial year.
Johanna, how do we solve the problem about gender segregation and the ability to encourage and promote more women into work and more creative ideas that Linda was mentioning about part-term and flexible working to attract more women into the local authority workforce, perhaps?
Well, I think there's a lot that could be done, but I go back to the point that I made earlier, which is that nobody in local government is... it has got the bandwidth at the moment to give... that agenda the focus that it deserves. And I think, you know, there is a real issue about how you attract people into local government itself, never mind increasing the diversity of those who might apply and be appointed. And all of this goes back to the discussions that we have on fair funding and pay. You will not, see real change and movement on these fundamentally important issues unless and until there is some long-term financial stability provided to local government that will allow them to invest in those issues. We want to be having conversations with COSLA that look to... how we can increase diversity, how we can ensure the use of new technology to help our members do their jobs, how we can attract younger people into the workforce. That is an issue as well. Unfortunately, all of our conversations at the moment are surrounded on the basis of pay, the lack of decent pay, cuts. And, you know, COSLA consistently say to us they don't have the funding to invest in decent pay rises, we would view them as, and that if they did invest in decent pay rises, that would cost even more of our members their jobs. But unfortunately, jobs are being cut at any rate. We are... at a crisis point in Scottish local government, there is no more that they can cut without it having a substantial a negative impact on the services that they are expected to provide and which our communities rely upon. So I think there needs to be a real reflection on what we actually need to be providing local authorities in terms of the support that's required.
OK, thank you very much for your contributions there, everyone. Back to you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. Before I bring in Pam Gosol, I'm just going to ask a very direct question, which I think both Linda and Joanna, you've been kind of touching on this, but So, Joanna, do you think the gender pay gap is improving? Is it improving?
I can't speak for every single local authority area. Certainly, it's an issue that we continue to try to address with local authorities on an individual basis, but also with COSLA during our national negotiations with them. I think more can certainly be done and should be done. We have certainly tried to provide COSLA with suggestions on how to do that. For example, if there is an agreed programme to bring workers up to that minimum £15 an hour within the space of 3 years, for example, there are guidelines that we can agree about how to ensure you gender pay-proof those changes to the pay system and structures. And we did that previously when we agreed the full consolidation of the living wage. We agreed a set of national guidelines about how it should be done, and we spent a huge amount of time working with local authorities on an individual basis to make sure it was done properly and appropriately, and that the equal pay implications of those changes were reviewed during that process, and to ensure that the gender pay gap reduced rather than widened. So that's a couple of things that I would say on that.
Thanks very much. I'm going to move on now. That was really helpful to get that clarity. And I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, panel. My question, before I go on to my main question, I wanted to touch on what Willie was speaking about, my colleague Willie, about diversity in the workforces. Now, Joanna, it's interesting you mentioned 60% vacancies in East Dunbartonshire. That is the West of Scotland region that I cover. I live there as well. And something that came up just actually last week, I was chairing a meeting between the council and between Milan Care Centre, which was caring for the elderly Asian, but also people that really needed that help. So what came out of that was one of the questions that were asked by the BAME community was the fact that people that make these decisions, whether cuts are made or services are changed, that on that panel, is there anybody that's diverse, I'm going to use those words, that can have those that thinking that what should this service look like? And one of the areas that they mentioned was they were getting shifted from one area to another facility, which they had no people speaking the language, no catering for their food that they eat. And what about the clothes they wear and how they're going to integrate? What's important is how they're going to integrate into with people from the Western society, and what is it that their culture needs? This was brought up time and time again in this meeting, and I was actually shocked. And don't get me wrong, the local government officers, the councillors, people working for the council, I think we're a bit stuck that to answer these questions. So do you think situations like this are going to come up more, that they can't serve diverse communities because they actually don't understand how to serve them, what their culture is, because they don't have the diverse representation in their workforce? Joanna, do you think that's going to come up more, and have you heard of things like this?
I don't know the details of the particular circumstances that you cite. I would say that local government officers are actually the people who implement political decisions. So the decision makers about where cuts would fall are local elected politicians. Just clarify the figure that I provided. It was vacancy rates as at December 2022 in social care. I would say that the local government workforce are doing absolutely the best job they can possibly do with the resources that they are provided at the moment to do it. The problem is that the resources they are provided with are not sufficient. That leads us to question why that is. that is the result of political decisions being made in council chambers and political decisions being made in Holyrood. Can only praise the local government workforce in terms of the efforts that they are making to serve their communities against a backdrop of what I would say is just cuts to the bone in terms of the services that they need, the workforce that is required to deliver it. And I think those that are working, striving to deliver for their communities day in, day out, are doing a very, very good job against absolutely terrible circumstances, if I'm honest. And that's why there is such an increase in the stress that our members experience, because they want to be delivering good local services to the communities that they serve. They don't want to be delivering a bad service. So clearly, when they're not provided the resources they need, that is going to take a toll, not just in terms of the physical and emotional efforts that they make to get the job done, but also because they care. And they care if they are struggling to provide a good service. So I don't think this is a simple answer, but I certainly don't think the answer to it is to criticise a workforce that is delivering whilst also being on its knees.
Thank you, Joanna, and I absolutely agree with you. The officers were brilliant, to be honest. They were really trying to make good of a situation. It was a public meeting, so that's why I'm speaking about it in here today. But obviously it's important that, you know, as an elected member, I stepped in to chair to help. But I'm just saying that it's sometimes not their fault. You're absolutely right that they had to deal with a difficult situation because they didn't have that diverse workforce. Is there anything Sean or Linda would like to add to, not probably the case, but the situation more, that how do we serve better diverse communities? Because we've got people coming in from refugees, asylum seekers, from people living here as well, born here as well, that how do we understand their cultures and how to deliver on the right service that we don't offend them, but we also help them?
Come on. So I think you're absolutely right. I think it's a wider issue of, and it's been touched on a few times already today, about how local government is becoming alienated, I think, from the communities they serve, particularly in maybe areas that have got multiple deprivation or different challenges in terms of culture and stuff like that. And I think the best way to do it is to try and just ensure that there's pathways for people and secure well-paid employment from those communities all the way through these organisations. And if we're in a situation where funding has been cut year on year and we're losing positions in the very jobs and that deliver the services on the front line, there's no entry point for people to come in for any community, turn onto the ladder and move up through the organisation and share those skills and experiences, then it's, of course, we're going to see more issues that are of a similar vein unless we try and reverse the current way of working, I suppose, would be the best way to say it at the minute.
Thank you. Chair, could I ask just one more question, please, if it's possible? Thanks. No, thank you for that. Just around recruitment, obviously, Scottish councils fail to recruit overall workers for basically one in four jobs. And we've heard from all three of you witnesses today that underfunding is the biggest challenge local government is facing today, with obviously funding being cut to the bone, leading to cutbacks on service provisions, as well as strikes over pay and conditions. I want to ask the question around, it's obviously becoming increasingly difficult to have these jobs looking attractive. So do you think they are more now unattractive around especially job security when people are looking for jobs? And what impact is this having on skill shortages and on local government's ability to deliver on their priorities? Yeah, Sean.
So I think we've all highlighted the high vacancy rate. And I think the issue isn't just about not being able to recruit or people not applying. I think there's an issue around, and my finance advisor at Glasgow sit behind me, so I better watch what I'm saying. But I think the issue is more about how these things are recorded and how accounts are done. So they'll say 60% of vacancies have not been filled for the last year, right? A lot of this may come back to, and it's anecdotal for my part, I don't have facts or figures, about how vacancies are managed when local government to save money, right? So if you are having to make a saving of X amount, The easiest way is not to backfill any of those vacancies, right? But the vacancies will sit. But if you have also systemically underfunded any services and you've not provided enough staff to deliver those services, that service then relies on the existing workforce more. So the existing workload then is dispersed amongst the remaining workforce. They try and pick up a wee bit more work, do the work a bit harder, a wee bit quicker, fit it all in. What happens is they get burnt out, they get sick, they get tired, they go off sick. But to replace those, or if you're adding another vacancy, but these people are never recruited to fill vacancies. The easiest way to fill a vacancy and maintain service provision is to take on agency staff, which incurs a higher cost. And I think if we look at any serious discussion around how we can't fill vacancies in local government, we need to have a serious discussion about the use of then of employment agencies in local government and how the two relate. I don't have all the answers in front of me. I probably wouldn't have if I sat here all day. But I think if it's a job of this committee to explore vacancies, they need to explore the use of employment agencies within local government.
Thank you for that, Sean. Just on that you say, obviously, they need to explore a lot more. But with obviously strikes, underpay and the conditions of underfunding, but does it actually, do you think that local government jobs will, it might be a question for Joanna, that local government jobs will become less unattractive, and especially around the job security, that, you know, people want certainty, they know that all this is happening out there. So would they apply for a local government job, or would they apply for the private sector job? What's more secure here? So it's just asking that question. Sean, sorry.
Very simply put, I think it's still a very secure job and very attractive job. I think local government provides not the services, but the work for a lot of people to build a family and a life around. The security is there, the flexibility is there. It's just that the pay is sometimes lagging. It's still dragging behind. And obviously the challenges that you've got once you're in terms of workload. I think people are beginning to realise that it's a hard, hard job, particularly in the lower end of a lot of these local government jobs. You're picking up a lot of slack that the communities rely on the services to deliver. These aren't just easy jobs that you can wake up and roll out of bed and go into, even at a lowest level. They're hard physical jobs, whether it's refuse collection, working in the schools or care. They're hard physically and mentally, and you'll have to put the hours in. And I think that's the biggest barrier, the pay compared to the physical effort. I think that if we can address that, you'll start to see a lot more people wanting to come back into local government.
Thank you. Joanna, do you want to say anything on that?
Yes, thank you. So I think obviously job security has increased in terms of issues of concern because of the amount of cuts that have been made necessarily because of the underfunding that local government has received. So job security is a concern. I think it's become an increasing concern. That's not to say that I disagree with Sean in terms of my analysis that these are good jobs, and once people do get into employment within local government, they are more likely to view them as secure jobs. The difficulty is in relation to attracting people to work in local government, and central to that is pay. So it is clear, and is a point that we have made both to COSLA and the Scottish Government, that if you want to increase the value of money in your pocket right now, today, in the middle of a cost of living crisis, you could apply to be a care worker within a local authority, but you might actually earn more money per hour by going to work in a fast food chain. Now, that's not a good position for local authorities to be in. We absolutely understand that with a local authority role comes other terms and conditions, which make that a more attractive role overall. But when you are in the middle of a cost of living crisis, people are much more concerned about the money that they have in their pocket today rather than all of the other benefits that might come with a job. So I think there is a bit of an analysis going on in terms of where people are choosing to work based on how they can how they can pay their mortgage today. Had we been in a much more stable financial situation as a country, then they might make different choices. But there is a massive focus on day-to-day pay, salary levels. And unfortunately, that is the key thing that's making it very difficult for local authorities to attract people into working for local government. So I'd go back to the fact that, you know, COSLA, Scottish Government could be a leader on this, could provide the funding to achieve a minimum rate of pay of £15 an hour, and that might help alleviate some of that pressure.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that response. I'm just going to remind us that so we've got about 10 minutes left of the session, but I think we've got some flexibility to go over a little bit. I'd like to invite everyone, to both my colleagues and Linda, Sean and Joanna, to try to keep our questions and our responses as tight as possible, because we're not even halfway through our questions. And I do think that quite a few of the things that we want to go on to ask may have already come out in previous questions, but there is some detail that we do want to get to. So with that, I wanted to pick up a question about the rates of absence. So the Accounts Commission highlighted that recruitment challenges and high sickness absence levels are considerably a source of pressure for councils. The overall absence level for non-teaching staff in 2021 to 22 were the highest on record at an average of 12.2 days per employee. So I'd be interested to hear what, maybe I'll start with Linda, what you think the key drivers are of this increase, and what can local authorities do to support staff to reduce levels of absence?
Briefly, and I'll let my colleagues come in, but I think that, you know, when you're looking at people taking time off work due to ill health, particularly if you're in a public sector role, it's not something people do easily. You know, there's very much an attitude of, well, you know, I've got a job to do and there's nobody else to do it if I'm not there, so I'll come in. But that's changed, and that's changed for a number of reasons. I think there's an impact probably of long COVID that should be looked at within those figures. I think there's, but the bigger issue is very much about workplace stress, and that workplace stress is coming from the pressure of having to do too much. And I think that that would be borne out. It was interesting looking at the Audit Commission's report itself and the case studies that went alongside it, where they looked at wellbeing initiatives. I mean, the initiatives that were listed were, you know, they were welcome for what they were, but none of them actually get to the bottom of tackling, either identifying or tackling what are the actual issues in terms of absence management that we need to get to. And we would argue again that it's about the workplace pressures and the stress that there comes from people being burnt out from having to do so much. You know, social care is one of the areas that there are the biggest recruitment problems in, and that is to do with pay, but it's also to do with what the job looks like once you're in it. You know, where the job is an intense job that is quantified into 15-minute chunks, where people are expected to deliver a service that's frankly almost undeliverable in that time. So that's why they end up working more than their time for nothing. You know, so there are specific issues, I think, within there. You know, all too often when Scottish Government had a mental health working group as well about employment, and they looked at signposting, you know, workforces to signposting workers to services, rather than saying what are the issues that are actually affecting people at work.
Very much for that. Anybody else got anything to add? Sean and then Joanna.
Sorry, Joanna. Just very quickly again, goes back to the point I made about it's all a consequence of cuts, right? So again, it's about how the existing workload doesn't deplete. You're not cutting the workload, but you're cutting the staff. So that work still needs to be done. People still need to be cared for, bins still need to be lifted, kids still need to be fed and looked after at school. But you're doing that with a much reduced headcount of staff. Right. And that existing workload sometimes doubles or triples on existing staff who are not growing any arms and legs. They're not getting 15 minutes extra in the day. If anything, they're getting less time to do more work. And I think if any of us in our professional lives had to experience that, then we'd all, I think, agree that it would have a massive impact both on our mental and physical wellbeing, and that impact again in absence. But one further point is that I think when that happens, it's very hard to get out of it. I spoke about a death spiral earlier, but I suppose a snowball would be a better way of looking at it. Once issues around absence happen in a service, or if there's a kind of higher absence, that workload is then still is moved to smaller and smaller people. That issue snowballs, and the work gets increasingly large for the remaining employees, the stress that they're under increases and increases, then if they go off that, it snowballs, and it's very hard to kind of put a stop to that and roll that snowball back up the hill. And I think there needs to be a whole culture change of how we approach this. And the best way, I would think, to do it just fairly quickly would be, rather than relying on an agency to fill the gap, we need to look at back about headcount, staffing levels, and build in contingencies. And contingencies in terms of having extra workers for the work that needs done to cover those within it, and they can step in at any time. I think local government used to have that before my time. I've heard it from many of my esteemed colleagues. We don't have that at the minute. And that seems to be the biggest issue I'm getting for our members, is we don't have contingencies in the service anymore. And that would be a huge role to play in helping people.
Thanks very much for that detail. Joanna, do you want to add anything?
Yes, just very quickly. So I agree about the points that have been made about the increase in workload for those who remain, given the cuts that have been made. But I think there's a wider point there also about the fact that because everybody is chasing their tail, you very often find that there isn't the sufficient attention to some people development that there could be. So particularly in terms of line managers and the softer skills around supporting individuals at work. So I cite as an example, the education support staff members that we have very often report violence at work and them experiencing violence in the workplace during the course of their jobs. And, I think better reporting, better investigation and prevention of all of that would certainly help them in terms of dealing with some of that, some of those issues, but also just ensuring that workplaces are safe for members to work in. There is, as Linda has said, also issues about long COVID. Given the jobs that our members do, they were more likely, particularly in the care sector, to pick up COVID through the course of their job. So there is certainly an issue with that as well. And the final point I'd say is that we do often find local authorities record absences in different ways. So I think better consistency in terms of reporting, recording, not just in terms of absence, but many other issues would also help, I think, us get a better picture of what's going on across the country.
Great. Thanks very much for all of that, everybody's response there. I'd like to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks again, Convener. It's a quick question, really, about the ageing workforce, perhaps, within local authorities. We hear, we read widely that we've got an ageing workforce, but we also hear that local government workers are retiring earlier. It seems a bit of a contradiction that you can't have both at the same time. What's your views on that? Do you think we do have an ageing workforce within our councils, and what can we do to address that? Maybe start with Sean this time.
I think we still do have an ageing workforce. The stuff that people retiring early, I think, is mainly fed from the fact that, again, it's a consequence of cuts. So if you're having to make savings as part of each year budget package, part of that is redundancy packages. And a lot of time, people who are at a pensionable wage will be asked to either take redundancy or take an early retirement rate. But that still comes back to the fact that those who remain are still, we're not recruiting anybody to replace posts. So it's the same workforce that have fed year on year is getting older. We're not recruiting, we're not bringing enough people in at the bottom that are younger, maybe at the bottom of the ladder, to replace them. So it's just the ageing workforce is slowly crawling forward, and people are retiring early due to savings. It just means that the headcount's reducing. So every time somebody retires, it doesn't mean we're replacing them with somebody that's younger. You know what I mean?
You can get early retirements plus a gradual increase in the relative age of the workforce.
Aye, so a lot of times local government will make strategic decisions about who has access to early retirement, and if it is part of service provision still, or if they're needed for service delivery. So if part of a savings package is to remove a certain aspect of service, that role might not be needed anymore, so to speak. I think they'll all be needed, but in terms of a local government, I can see the value, and they might think, well, that post's almost been made redundant by cuts.
If that's the case, Linda and Joanna, what can we do to try to resolve that or even reverse that? Linda?
I'll let Joanna fill that. She'll probably be pleased.
Joanna, what can we do to try and reverse that trend then, if that's what's happening?
Well, I go back to some of the evidence that I've already given around how we attract people into local government. So pay is certainly a factor in all of that. The thing that I'd add to what Sean has already said about the use of early retirement in the process of cutting roles is that what that does mean is that very often the most experienced workers, those that have perhaps got longer service with local authorities are ones that are choosing to take voluntary early retirement. And councils suffer when that knowledge leaves the workforce. So it's not just about the vacancy rates, it's about the skills and experience that councils are losing through the continued cuts that are being made and how that impacts the delivery of services at a local level.
OK. Thanks very much for that, Joanna. Thank you. Convener?
Thank you. Thank you, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosall.
Chair, I'm quite happy to ask this question, the next one, to the direct to the councils, if it's okay.
Could you ask it here as well?
Yeah, okay, please. That's fine. No, sorry. I was just saying out of time, that's why. Yeah. Sorry, right, okay. No worries. Thank you. In the past, obviously, the committee's heard about disproportionate impact on overall reduction in local authority personnel has had on council departments, particularly in planning and building standards and upcoming pieces of legislation proposed by the SNP Green Government, including the new build heat standards and the short-term Let's licensing scheme, undoubtedly lead to an influx of applications to such departments. And my question is around, are these relevant departments adequately staffed and resourced to deal with an increase in workload without having any adverse impact on other stakeholders? So I think I'd ask Joanna first, yeah?
So I would say that the areas of local government that have seen the most severe cuts over the past 10 years, if you look at the Accounts Commission report published in May of this year, clearly demonstrates that the planning is an area that has seen the highest level of cuts of all local authority services. Central support services were not far behind that. Culture and leisure, environmental and road also big decreases to their funding. But in the planning department, for example, I mean, those cuts, it was like 40% of their budget. So do I think these services are adequately resourced? No, I don't. We have seen huge impacts in these areas. So to give them additional workloads on top of what they already have with resources that have diminished considerably over the past 10 years, I think is concerning, and certainly I think additional resource needs to go into those areas.
Thank you, Joanna. Sean or Linda?
I think I'd agree with that, and also if you think about what I said earlier about, you know, what's the ambition for local government? Are they just doing what they've always done, or are they doing something different? Now, some of the priorities that have been set both through the Verity House Agreement and Scottish Government's own priorities around just transition and net zero, that will be new work. Some of that is new work that will come to local authorities that they will have to play their part. You know, looking at, you know, local authority housing, heating, retrofitting, the other things that they will have ambition to do. And these will be new areas that need done, and there will not be the workforce to do them.
Yeah, just to quickly. No, we don't have the workforce, but that doesn't mean to say we shouldn't try. I think any new projects that do come online need to be well resourced, and I think they could be a stimulus for economic recovery. And I think local government needs to be the foundations for any efficient and proper economic recovery in wider society. It starts with local government. These projects are admirable. We need to invest to get the returns on them.
Great, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, convener. thanks for your contribution so far this morning. It's been interesting, and clearly couched and framed in terms of a perception that there's been reductions in headcount that's causing things to be more difficult than they might otherwise have been. But if I look at the data, and you can maybe help me square this circle, but if you look at the numbers, local authority FTE headcount over the last 5 years has actually increased by 21,000, by nearly 9% increase. So I'd just like to understand your perspective on why we're in a position where what you're articulating is cuts and reductions in headcount, whereas the actual reality is the headcount has increased quite significantly over the last few years. I don't know who wants to start with that.
I can start.
Sure.
Yep. So, mentioned the last 5 years, and that period with the pandemic, and there was immediate measures put in place and funding secured from various levels of government to ensure that staff were recruited to deliver, maintain key and essential services. I imagine the devil will be in the detail, Ivan, but I imagine that will be a part of it. I think if you look at the general trend since 2008 and over the last 10, 15, maybe more years, headcount is drastically reduced. I have various members in Glasgow City Council who regularly tell me that in terms of parks and gardeners, we used to have 1,300 staff 10 years ago. We now have just over 200. Street sweepers was similar. We've now just got over 300. Imagine those trends are the same. You walk into any kitchen in any school and you ask the head cook, the head caterer, how many staff have you got, how many staff should you have? There's at least 3 out of the 5 staff you have, maybe, in the kitchen. I think, anecdotally, if they walk into any workplace and ask them if the headcount has been reduced, the workers themselves and the front line of delivering these services will tell you they absolutely have. I think I need to see the detail you're talking about, but I accept that the pandemic did bring in additional sources of funding and headcount.
Now, thanks very much for that, and that's, again, makes us even more interesting because you're quoting concrete examples of specific departments. But if you actually, and you talked about a 10-year time frame, so if I look at 10 years, the headcount now, Q3 2023, is actually up 13,000 on what it was 10 years ago in Q3 2013. So the headcount has increased over that 10-year period as well, so that was regardless of COVID. And I suppose the second question is then, if a lot of people were brought in to do COVID-specific stuff, clearly we're now post-pandemic, are those people getting redeployed, or should be they redeployed, or what should that position be? Because clearly if the argument was they were needed for COVID and we're now beyond COVID, what is the situation we're looking at there?
Sorry, what was the question?
So you said that headcount was down on what it was 10 years ago. The reality is it's up on what it was 10 years ago.
And
you
said that Scotland.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And you said that the people were all brought in for COVID. So if all those people were brought in for COVID in the last few years, were past COVID, what are those people doing now?
So there has been a large push by employers, particularly where I have, to do what's called robust vacancy management. So if MD has had long COVID and has not been able to return to work, their position has been replaced temporarily through that funding. Anyone who's not been able to return to work has been capabilitied out the door, is to a colloquial term. Right? So there's been a reduction and there's been a transfer maybe. And the headcount, overall headcount, as you say, might have increased, but there's been a transition there from people who've come into cover posts to go back out. I can't speak across Scotland to see why there's been an increase, but I think over 10, 15 years, the needs of services will change. How things have been redirected will change, and where additional resources have been placed in, removed from certain areas to reduce those and moved into other areas to increase headcount as a natural consequence of time, I suppose. And I would need to, I'd love to see a bit more detail on some of the stuff you're talking about, but I maintain that for the experience of my members who deliver frontline services is that headcount is reducing drastically and it's having a massive impact on their ability to do their job.
Okay, so maybe the headcount or somewhere else. Joanna, I don't know if you get any comments on that.
Yes, so during that period, we have also seen early years expansion, for example. So there's a particular area which has seen an expansion of the workforce to deliver services, which were committed to by the Scottish Government. So that's one area that directly contributes to an increase in staffing numbers. But I think the devil is in the detail, because while some areas have seen an expansion, both in terms of workforce numbers, but also services provided and funding committed, others have seen very drastic reductions. So I think it's very difficult to put everything into one pot and say everything's fine because headcount's gone up. It might have gone up in some areas, but that has, in our experience, been directly related to policy priorities by the Scottish Government, for which there has been ring-fenced funding provided to local authorities. The areas of service provision which have not seen secure ring-fenced funding provided have suffered cuts.
OK, no, thanks. That might help clarify. And you're right, there's clearly some work to be done to dig into the detail, but I just thought it was illuminating that the data has shown a very different picture than what the what the narrative is. I've got other stuff, but frankly, I was going to leave that until the next panels. OK, thank you. Sure, sorry,
well,
Linda.
I mean, we had a briefing a while ago, which was around looking at local government as well, and the figures we had, and again, it's, you need to look at where different sources came from, but the figures we had around local government was that we had a fall in employment from 325,000 workers in 2006, and down to 260,000 in 2022, and that was excluding police and fire as well. So, I mean, there's maybe different ways that we've come up with those figures.
Just come back on that, clarify those numbers you've quoted did include police and fire. So 30,000 of that reduction was as a consequence of recategorisation of police and fire. And if you look at that number, 262 is the number we're at actually just now. So if you look back over the last 5 and the last 10 years, the number actually has come up quite significantly. Yeah, if you go back to 2006, it's a different story. But if we're talking about pressures today, things that happened nearly 20 years ago is obviously a different conversation.
John.
Very quickly. I think you're right. I think it is illuminating. And the areas that, as John has said, were ring-fenced and there was national policy objectives that we have seen an increase in those to deliver those services. In areas we haven't, we've seen a decrease. I don't think we're in disagreement here. And I think that leads the questions earlier about the impact of the Verity House Agreement. Then we need to look at what impact that will have. Are we then putting the accountability for cuts? Are we shifting that around like a political hot potato? And what impact will that have? So that is illuminating. It's interesting to take away.
I think you're absolutely right. I think it's getting under the detail of that and seeing where that addition in headcount has been and for what purposes and how much of that's temporary and how much it needs to be permanent. And as a consequence, as you said, what of the increase in service provision? Because I don't deny that there has been, as a result of policies and elsewhere, an increase, but it's really hard to kind of get a focus on what's actually going on, looking at it from 30,000 feet without passing out the data to understand the detail on it. So thanks.
OK. Thanks very much. Yes, there's some work there to be done, finding that detail. That concludes our questions. So thank you so much for coming in this morning and sharing your perspectives in this discussion about workforce in Scotland. And I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of our witnesses. Thank you. On our second panel this morning, we're joined in the room by Martin Booth, who's the Executive Director of Finance at Glasgow City Council, and Paul Manning, who's the Executive Director of Finance and Corporate Resources and Deputy Chief Executive Officer of the South Lanarkshire Council. And we are joined online by Robert Emmett, who is the Executive Director of Corporate Services at Dundee City Council. I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting this morning. So we're going to just turn to our questions from members. And as previously mentioned, we'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible. But if you'd like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks. And Robert, as you're appearing virtually, please type an R into the chat function. There's no need for you to operate your microphones, as we'll be doing that for you automatically. And sometimes there's a bit of a pause before that comes on, so we know about that. So I'm going to actually begin with the same general question that I asked the previous panel. And I'd be interested to hear, and maybe I'll direct it to you, Martin, so you know it's coming initially. So be interested to hear if you could highlight what the main challenge you believe is for the local government workforce at the moment.
Okay, yes, thanks, Chair. I think a lot of the comments that we heard from the trade unions, we would echo those comments. The challenges of the resources that are available for local government around directed spending means that the pressure on our workforce is ever increasing. The challenges of recruitment across all grades, and probably for the first time at more senior grades in recent years, is much more challenging. And we wouldn't disagree with any of the trade unions' comments about pay, but it's the affordability of that pay. And actually, I don't think we disagree with the trade unions on that either. I think they acknowledged that affordability was an issue. There's challenges across the board: recruitment, retention, resources to do anything about that.
Anybody else got anything to add? Paul?
In terms of picking up on Martin's answer, I'll not reiterate Martin's points, but I'm in complete agreement with him. Maybe just add a little bit on that. On recruitment, obviously you had a lengthy discussion with the trade unions about why some of the reasons are around that. One of the facets of that is recruitment into leadership posts as well. Right? And part of that we could attribute to the fact that over time, the differentials between pay have become compressed, and it makes it less appealing for people to take those roles. So that's a facet that exists in this as well.
Thanks very much for that. Robert, have you got anything to add?
Nothing specific at
no.
this time.
Okay. Yep, great, thanks. And so you obviously, you're... So this is a question about the New Deal with local government, and I'd be interested to hear what you think might be some of the key ways that the New Deal could support local authorities in addressing the challenges faced in terms of workforce. And Martin, I'll start with you.
So again, you know, the Verity House Agreement is something that we're all supportive of in principle. It's about recognising the importance of the relationship between local government and Scottish Government, about that kind of mutuality of respect, about understanding or respecting the local democratic right of local government. I think where we are just now is we're all supportive of that as a principle, but you know, actions speak louder than words. We have had something like the Verity House Agreement previously. The Concordat was signed, I think, in 2008 or 2009 and didn't last for a very long time, really, before it kind of unravelled. So what we need is we need actions that back up that position. We need transparency over decision making. We need clear accountability. So we need clear demonstration of the pressure that's been placed on local government finances. I think I said to this committee before, when I gave evidence about last year, there was lots of information put out where it compared Scottish Government's budget in real terms, but compared it to local government's budget in cash terms. Now, that's comparing apples and pears. We need to be transparent and compare apples with apples or pears with pears.
Well, this is part of the work we're doing, isn't it? We're going to see what fruit tree we get later on. Paul, did you want to come in?
In terms of the Verity House Agreement, again, I'd echo what Martin said. if I go back to part of the discussion already this morning around the importance of funding, right, and that relationship, and that being the basis for a good relationship in terms of pay and workforce, part of what I'd be hoping for within the Verity House Agreement are you know, the dimensions within it that I'd like to see come through, that there is a look towards a fiscal framework which would stop a drift in funding away from local government, which we have seen over a period of time. And another facet around that, which is really critical in terms of funding, is the issue of ring-fenced and directed spend. So one of the tenets within the Verity House Agreement is that the default position is that there wouldn't be ring-fenced or directed spend. Now, that is one of the reasons why you see a skewing of the impact of having to close budget gaps within councils to certain parts of the workforce. So big parts of what councils do are effectively protected from cuts. And by that, I'm thinking principally of education because of the prescription around teacher numbers. And it's also very hard for local authorities to make savings within the area of activity that sits within integrated health and social care partnerships. So what that means is the burden in terms of having to make savings falls on the minority of a council spend which is left. So if I can give you the example of my own council, between education and the activity that's within the health and social care partnership, it accounts for about 75% of what we spend. It's difficult to close the budget gap by going to that 75% because of the protections that are afforded to it. So it means that you're left trying to close the budget gap by looking at the 25% of activity that's left. So that covers the things that you would traditionally think of as local government services, from cleansing and waste, planning, for example, services like her own in terms of back office services. These are the points Joanna was making earlier on. So if through the Verity House Agreement we can start to get more flexibility in local government's budgets to address anomalies like that, I think that would greatly help the position.
Robert, do you have anything to add there?
Just a couple of points if I may, Convener. So first of all, I think it's important, as Martin was saying, we have an open, transparent conversation, but also perhaps that it's longer term. So we've been dealing for the past period with single-year settlements. And if we think of that in the context of trying to plan our workforce and the delivery of our services, then if we can stretch that out to 2 and 3 years, then that will help with good quality planning. I think there's strong alignment in terms of the objectives that we're trying to achieve in local and national government. And the way we achieve them should be by making sure we're having an open discussion about our policies. And just one further point, if I may, Paul mentioned the fiscal framework, as well as thinking about the spending, we also need to be thinking about income and about tax raising and how we fund public services, and having an open discussion around what the opportunities are around that.
Thanks very much for those additional points. Now going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone. We heard in the last panel that everybody wants more money to come to local government, everybody. And there's a proposal on the table regarding the council tax, which, if approved, would bring £176 million extra into local government. I could ask if your three councils have reached a position in this yet and what their view is.
Again, we're here trying to represent all 32 councils on this position. We are just finalising a response on behalf of the Director of Finance section towards it, which Paul prepared, so I'll let him come in a second. But the first point I'd make is council tax affecting bands E to H doesn't fall equally across the country. So again, to use Glasgow as an example, 83% of Glasgow's houses are bands A to D, and in fact, more than 10% of the remaining chunk is band E. So our bands F to H are less than 7% of our total housing stock. So it wouldn't fall equally. We're also aware that among those higher bands, there is still quite a high percentage of council tax reduction. And I think the figures you're quoting are before council tax reduction. So the while we would absolutely support more money for local government, there needs to be care taken that that this is applied in a way that benefits everybody in society, not just the wealthier suburbs.
Well, and again, absolutely echo what Martin said. Now, that starts to form the basis of a response that we were putting in as local government directors of finance. What the point we would make is this isn't a substitute for local government finance or local tax reform. Right? This is simply adjusting what is there at the moment. And the question of local government finance and taxation reform, right? And Robert mentioned this a second ago, is long-standing, right? And you know, a final fundamental answer to that is still awaited. So it isn't that. It doesn't even address the issues around valuation, right? So you know, essentially, you're still running with a system of bans that references values in the early 90s, which can't be satisfactory, and this doesn't address that. Martin made the point about the benefit not necessarily falling equally, and it would need to go through some form of distribution process for there to be a proper equalisation of benefit from that. But the money that you quoted, Mr. Coffey, is absolutely the reason why ourselves as directors of finance across 32 councils would be supportive of this. Given the funding position that councils are facing, I mean, we can talk more about that later on, given the position that we're facing, we would have to look at that as a potential mitigation against cuts that are going to have to come against council services. So that's the overwhelming reason why we would say this has to be looked at. So a cautionary point off the back of that, we would protect, you know, ideally, in order to mitigate the potential effects of cuts, I would look for that in 2024-25. That may not be doable at this point in 2023. It may not be possible even to make things like system changes to get that done for April 2024. So it might be something that we would need to accept over a phased period of time.
Thanks for that, Paul. Robert, any comment on that question from your perspective?
I suppose just to reiterate my point around having to look at the value of public services, and if we're going to deliver public services that we aspire to, making sure that we're raising the taxes that relate to it, and that the burden of those taxations is appropriately distributed. Certainly, if you look at where current house values are and the proportion of income to tax, then the system is not really fit for purpose, I would contend, from a professional perspective. So it is due for reform. I think that's a submission that we have made before. And in the meantime, though, certainly my council has taken the view that we should be looking to do something here to alleviate the burden and to protect services in the forthcoming period.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I wonder if I could just ask you a question about inequality, and particularly pay inequality. We only need to look back some years to the position in Glasgow, where that council fought tooth and nail to prevent equal pay for women, and that has been overcome, I'm glad to say. But do you still see pay inequality, particularly gender inequality, still being there and a problem to overcome within Scotland's councils, and something we should continue to address?
I should perhaps declare an interest as Director of Finance in Glasgow City Council. We are still finalising that process. We're going through through the process of a job evaluation exercise that will then lead to a new pay and grading system that will be as equality proof as anything possibly can be, but that is not 100% guarantee. From a pay inequality, I think issues are long-standing historical issues over what in the past were perceived to be the things that led to a job being higher paid. And I think the world's massively moved on since then, and it's dealing with those long-term historical inequalities is the issue. I'm pretty certain that in Glasgow, our gender pay is actually positive So women on average earn more than men in Glasgow. But that's not to take away from the fact that for our lowest paid staff, they are predominantly occupations that are dominated by females. But that's being addressed, and as we go through our job evaluation and new pay and grading system, we'll hopefully resolve that.
Thanks very much for that, Martin. Paul, just your own perspective on the gender pay gap. Is it closing or widening in your view?
The short answer for my own council is that it's closing, right? But it's still a negative gender pay gap. So it's just over 3% currently. Now, that has improved significantly across the past couple of years, and I do expect it to improve again when we get next year's stat, and I'll explain why in a wee moment. The majority of our council's workforce are women. So it's nearly 74%. So it's 73.7%. Actually, the national figure is 73.8%, right? So we're as near as damn it right on the national average. If I picked the education workforce, where the position continues, there is a high percentage of female employees within the education workforce, but there's actually a positive gender pay balance within that workforce. So, on average, women are paid more than men. However, within the overall workforce, so that includes teachers and non-teachers, it's 3%. And how that is or has been and continues to be addressed over a period of time, unfortunately, for societal reasons, we have women in those lower paid roles. Now, part of a conscious decision taken by our council, taken by many councils, is to try and increase the level of pay in those lower paid roles. So that's done through things like Pay Award. It's been done through things like implementing the Real Living Wage. It's been done in our own authority and within others through progressive reviews in terms of job evaluation, looking at the content within jobs and trying to properly evaluate it. And that's led to a closing of the gap, by and large, by lifting the pay of those lower graded posts. So that's actually, it's reduced it to 3%. We've had a review, a job evaluation review of home care staff across the past year, which has now come to fruition. That's led to a significant increase in the pay for those staff. So again, that's a group of people who are predominantly female. That will benefit that gap next year. I would expect it to reduce much further. Right, so those are the sort of measures that ours and other councils use to try and close those gaps.
It's really encouraging to hear that as well, Paul. Thank you very much for that. Robert, could you offer your own perspective on the gender pay gap issue?
Just a couple of comments. So we're in a slightly better position, I think, than Paul. I think our gap is just under 1% now in terms of where we're at. I think I just want to go back perhaps to Martin's comments and say that the workforce has evolved over many years in particular ways. And one of the biggest challenges is the fact that we have, I'm not quite sure what the professional phrase for it is, but we have jobs which are typically or have typically been undertaken by one gender or another. And one of the things that we're looking at is how do you find opportunities to make sure that there's equality of opportunity across all of the jobs within the workforce to everyone. So it's something that we take very seriously, but that, you know, some of that is quite embedded in the way we work and the way we are as a society. So changing that requires more effort.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Robert. Thank you. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. My question's around recruitment. Obviously, we've heard this morning that vacancies are high. Scottish councils fail to recruit workers for one in four jobs. And we've heard from the panel before and yourself that underfunding is one of the biggest challenges local government has today, and with these cuts, obviously it leads to cutbacks on service provisions as well as strikes over pay and conditions. With obviously lower pay and uncertainty of that job security, what impact do you think it will have on the skill shortages and on local government's ability to deliver on these priorities, and also people moving more to the private sector, we've heard, because of that job security and that pay? Do you think, what kind of effect is that having? that we've got people, less people coming into local government. And could I ask Paul that, please, first? Thanks.
Listen, happy to pick up on that. I do still think local government is an appealing career for a whole range of people in Scotland. What I do think has started to have an impact on recruitment is in part that the fact that we are all, and I include the private sector, we're fishing in a shallower pool, right? If I look at my own area's statistics, levels of unemployment, right, are at a record low. What we do have is a higher level of economic inactivity, right, which plays into that as well. But there is a smaller group of people that we're trying to recruit from. Right, and some of the roles that local government have are challenging. And in some places, you can get equivalent money through doing things that aren't necessarily as challenging as the roles that the local government offers. So councils are having, I think, to work harder in order to recruit and fill posts. And that leads to some of the statistics that we've talked about this morning in terms of posts that are unfilled. We are, I think, as a sector, becoming increasingly innovative in terms of how we reach out and we engage with a potential workforce. Not everybody goes online or picks up a particular paper every Friday and tries to find a job that way. So if I pick examples that my own council's used and that I know other councils use as well, we've tried to be more innovative, running things like job fairs in specific areas in different places. So, for example, in social clubs, working people's clubs, simply putting on events, getting folk in, showing them the jobs that are available in their geographic areas where travel might not be a boundary. And through that, we've successfully brought people back into our workforce and back into the labour market generally. We've tried to do things like that. One area where it's particularly difficult to recruit people is drivers. Right, so for things like from buses to bin lorries, local authorities are going to use drivers. So we've had to be very innovative, again, using techniques like the ones I've described to try and get people back in to do those types of jobs. And again, another big area across things like professional services, from things like procurement to accountancy, are graduate apprenticeships. So rather than going looking for simply people coming out of university, even trying to look at people who are school-age leavers as well, bringing them in, putting them through a degree and a professional qualification while working for the local authority. So these are all things that are done to try and innovate and to try and move things on. So I'm not despairing in that respect, right? I do think that local government is still a career that stands comparison with others. There are other things that make it worthwhile working in local government. And I do think councils are reaching out and engaging and doing their best to fill these posts.
Yeah, no, and to build on Paul's positivity at the end there, I think it is still a fantastic place where you can build a career. I think we have a first-rate pension fund. We have very flexible working conditions and conditions of service for lots of staff. While the job security is maybe not seen by the public as strong as it was in the past, most councils still have a no compulsory redundancy policy. So there is still job security there. But as our trade union colleagues said earlier, the workload is increasing, and it's increasing quite substantially. And pay is a challenge. We don't have the flexibility, and some of it is linked to equal pay, but some of it is linked to funding. Where we can compete with the private sector. We will lose particularly professional staff for quite substantial pay rises and for a job that's probably less taxing. There's an accountancy joke in there somewhere. But we've got examples of people that really have built careers. So I'm not going to name a name here, but one of my very senior team grew up in the east end of Glasgow, got enough qualifications to get into university, started university, but it became apparent quite quickly that his family needed him to bring a wage in, and university wasn't bringing a wage in. So he took a job as a clerical officer with the council. He's built a career. He's gone to university through day release. He's professionally qualified, and he's now, you know, head of service in a very big department across Scotland. And he's very committed to Glasgow because of that. I'm not going to name his name, so I don't think he'll ever leave local government, because he absolutely is committed that local government gave him an opportunity to do the training and the professional qualifications that his circumstance had made it difficult for him to do otherwise. From a recruitment point of view, you know, this time last year I had 8 qualified accountant vacancies within my team. We went to the market, we couldn't get anybody that was suitably qualified. So we made a decision. So we employed 10 graduates and we employed 5 apprentices. So people that weren't at degree level. They're both going through a programme. One's a 3-year programme, one's a 5-year programme to become qualified accountants. But in the short term, that brings lots of challenges. My managers agreed that they would take trainees rather than not getting anyone at all. But it increases their workload because they have to train these people. And it will be better this year because they've got second-year trainees, not first-year trainees. But it continues to be challenging.
I don't know if
Robert, did you want to come in?
I think just a couple of points. I think that there's no doubt that there's a challenge in terms of the availability of the workforce. We know that in Dundee, I think the figure's around 10 or 11,000 people who are not economically active. And one of the challenges is finding ways to come get people back into work or into work in a constructive way. And it's not just the public sector that we know from our work with employability that's struggling with employing people. So the type of innovative approaches that Paul and Martin were talking about are relevant. But even when we've successfully trained someone up, for example, as a tradesperson, they can be offered double the money to go and work in the commercial sector somewhere in the short term. So the remain challenges whilst we have an aging population. This is an ongoing challenge for us as a workforce to be planning ahead, and particularly as Martin was describing, training our own staff who've then got a greater commitment to the work that we're doing.
I've actually got a little bit of a supplementary on that. So I think this is about rural employment. So from what I understand, about a third of the rural population in Scotland is employed in the public sector. And I just wondered how things are going from your perspective in terms of the challenges of recruitment. Is it challenging there in similar ways, or is it different? I know you're not rurally based, but I'm hoping you might have the big picture. Paul?
I'll pick that up, because I'll probably lay claim to be more of a rural authority than Glasgow, right, which probably applies to every council in Scotland. There are challenges in specific areas, and that arises partly through the way the population is dispersed. Also things like transport links, right? So accessibility to good public transport, regular public transport that suits your working hours can be problematic. We do see, and this is probably influenced the way that the council has delivered certain services over a period of time. For example, through things like care services, it can be more difficult to recruit in the rural part of South Lanarkshire than it is in the urban part. And for that reason, sometimes we've used outside care providers where they're available. And that isn't necessarily the case right across that whole geographic area. So it can be difficult in those respects, right, in providing services and in recruiting people. Part of what I went back to earlier on around the things that we've done to try and address that is targeting recruitment exercises. So rather than simply putting out a general advert that runs across the whole area, go to the specific community, make the people who you're talking to aware of the specific vacancies in their area. And that type of targeted recruitment seems to have borne fruit. But I can't take away from the fact it's a dimension of a greater challenge in the rural community than it is in the urban setting.
Thanks very much for that.
Yeah,
Robert, come on in.
I don't know if you know, but previously I was Director of Finance with Coran and Yellen Shear, and in a Island communities, certainly public sector jobs, carried a greater weight and they made a greater contribution towards the economy in terms of the work they were doing. But certainly I know that recruitment is a more significant challenge, particularly for professional posts in those locations. And if you think about trying to provide care services, as Paul alluded to, in very remote places, the availability of staff, particularly that we see in the city as being challenging, is very challenging. So it requires more bespoke solutions around what you can do. But that just mirrors, I think, population decline and the fact that we're still seeing both an aging population and a population moving to the cities still, I think, and needs effective workforce planning. The one thing I would say is that more flexible ways of working that have come on the, off the back of COVID have helped in some cases.
Thanks. Thanks very much for that. I'm going to move on. Okay. So in the previous panel, we had a conversation with them about the rates of absence, and we heard about the from Sean Bailey the snowball effect. And I just wonder what your thoughts are, and also I think from Joanna about a need to the fact that local government records absentees in different ways and a call for kind of more consistent reporting. So I wonder what you think from your perspective are the key drivers of the increase and what local authorities could do to support staff to reduce rates of absence.
I certainly couldn't disagree with any of the comments that my colleague Sean Bailey made about the pressure on our workforce. I also think there is a significant impact on the back of COVID, both with people that are suffering from long-term conditions, but also people that are reviewing, you know, about looking after their own health, and perhaps people in the past would have come into work that are choosing to protect their own health and not to take risks in that area. I don't recognise the comments that were made about a different way of calculating, perhaps between the public sector and the private sector, but I think local government stats will be pretty consistently applied through things like the local government benchmarking framework, which are never perfect, but I think there's a level of consistency there in how we record things. So I don't think that's a particular issue, but maybe different from how the private sector do it.
Add to that.
I would agree. I think in terms of inconsistencies, my view is that those that did exist have been ironed out over the years. Other colleagues may answer differently. In terms of why the figures have reached the level that they have, again, I would go back to the point that was made by Martin. I think COVID in those 21, 22 figures still plays an impact. I think there's an aspect that's in there as well around the fact that people were stretched across the period of the pandemic, and there was maybe still a residual impact of that borne out in things like levels of psychological reasons for absence, right? And that lifting the figure to the levels that it did. I do think we have an older workforce, right? And I think that brings its own challenges as well in terms of levels of absence, simply levels of absence. If I pick on the area of home care within my own authority, I think somebody told me recently that the average home carer is a 58-year-old lady. So in terms of the demographic of people in their late 50s, there are going to be more health challenges there. There are going to be more reasons for absence. Right? And I think that's something that you're seeing more as we've come out of the pandemic, is around that ageing workforce and the impact that that has. So those are some of the reasons that I do think sit behind that.
Thank you very much. Robert, would you like to add to that?
No, Convener, thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to bring Willie Coffey in.
Yeah, thanks again, Convener. It's just on that issue, Paul, that you mentioned there about the ageing workforce. How, in your view, can we have an ageing workforce if we're seeing more people retiring early?
I think what you're seeing, right, are different groups of people, right? So, I referenced a particular group of people in terms of a home care staff who have got an average age in their late 50s. I think the group of people who you are seeing retire earlier, and this is my own anecdotal experience in this, maybe aren't working in that area, or maybe in things like more senior or managerial roles, right? I do think you are seeing within the local government workforce what you would call a hollowing out, right? So you're seeing experience and you're seeing managerial experience go from the workforce, right? So my point is you could have those two phenomena existing, but within different groups within your workforce.
Similar experience in Glasgow, Martin, and for yourself, Robert?
Yes, I think it is in Glasgow. Anyone that retires under early retirement or voluntary retirement, I have to sign off. So we have quite strict controls around that. And actually, they're not just in senior roles. They are across the piece. We've got a lot of people that do flexible retirement. Again, a lot of it to do with health, and it's something we're very keen to support because we are concerned about the kind of brain drain among senior people. And I think Joanne referred to this in her earlier answer about the concern over lots of experience disappearing. So if we can support somebody towards retirement by retaining them for maybe 3 days a week for a period of time to allow them to transition into retirement, which I think actually is a good thing in itself. So we are seeing a number of people retiring. That's how we're dealing with a lot of the pressures on our budgets. We have to reduce our headcount, and the easiest way is for people to retire either through normal retirement processes or through a voluntary redundancy early retirement process. And we're not recruiting this in the same numbers at the entry level end of younger people coming through. So that is leading to an ageing workforce, and we're all ageing, unfortunately.
Thanks very much for that, Martin. Robert, any additional perspective on that issue about the ageing workforce?
Just a couple of comments, I suppose. If you look at how our workforce in Dundee, it is pretty much the same size as it was in 2019, and we've seen a change in the workforce. We've seen a shift away from corporate services and some neighbourhood services and growth in education and children and family services. And if you look, though, at the workforce that's underneath it in some of those services, there are parts of the workforce in neighbourhood services, for example, where the majority of the workforce are in their late 50s. And we're seeing presumably what was a workforce that came in at a particular time reaching towards the end of their career. And one of our challenges that we're concerned about is retaining expertise and knowledge in services as we go forward. So that's where our workforce planning comes in, about where are the changes coming. And we've got heat maps within the council that show, where are the changes coming and help us think about what we might be doing to prepare for loss of particular groups of staff at particular times.
Okay. Many thanks for that, everyone. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair. My question is around earlier on we spoke about basically work pressures on departments. So we've heard that there's disproportionate impact on overall reduction in local authority personnel on certain council departments, for example, planning, building standards departments, and upcoming pieces of legislation proposed by the SNP Green Government, including the new build heat standards and the short-term LETS licensing scheme, will undoubtedly have influx of applications to such departments. And I wanted to ask if basically you feel that these departments are adequately staffed and resourced to deal with an increase in this kind of workload without having adverse effects on stakeholders. So this time I'll go to Martin first. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, no, there is difficult to recruit across all professional grades, including planning officers, building control officers, environmental health officers, as well as surveyors, accountants, lawyers. Difficult in all of these areas. For the kind of planning, building control, environmental health, there's additional pressures because the volume of people coming out with relevant graduate qualifications are less. There is less places where these subjects are studied than there was historically, and that leads to challenges itself. It's easier. There's more people graduating with an accountancy degree, so that is less challenging, although it continues to be challenging, and we're still having to recruit and train our own. But the other real issue in this area, again, and Paul touched on it earlier, is the directed spend, that where social care and education have been protected by directed spend decisions, and the area that's left, which includes all of those professional services, is the area where the cuts have to be made. So the pressure on resources within these areas is very, very significant.
Robert, do you want to say anything on this?
Martin's captured the main points. I think there's no doubt that the work that we're doing in local government has changed, and we need to be smarter about what we are doing and how we are doing it. And I think it's incumbent on all of us to look at how we can use the resources that we've got and the scarce resources to be most effective across the public sector. So we should be thinking about the outcomes that we're trying to achieve and what we are trying to achieve. So there is a challenge filling particular posts, and there is a change in the way that we are delivering services in local government, but we should be prepared to look at different ways of doing things as we go forward, and particularly looking at reduction of effort and how things are done. So my personal observation would be that we've got a lot of bodies in the public sector. We've got all sorts of people who are doing similar things and looking at doing similar things, and ways that we can find of reducing duplication so resources are focused at the front line, and the direct services that we need to deliver should be our priority. So whilst I'm an accountant by training, you know, we're not a means to an ends, we're to support the function that we're trying to deliver. And I suppose where I'm coming from there is some people will be uncomfortable with change as it comes. And we need to be trying to adapt as organisations. And again, just to go back to why our workforce planning is so important, that we're thinking about the direction we're going in and where we can collaborate and how we might be doing things different. What might we be looking like as organisations, you know, in 5 years' time?
Again, I'll not go over the points that have already been made. In terms of Robert stressing the importance of workforce planning, something that would help greatly with workforce planning is a greater degree of financial certainty. Right? So it's if we know for a period of time there that the level of money that we're working with, and you mentioned the commitment to net zero and planning towards that. So at the moment, we're really working, you know, in the absence of a funding structure for that moving forward to those targets in the next decade. So if we had a greater degree of the extent to which these commitments were going to be honoured financially, and a greater degree of certainty in our financial settlements, it takes away from inhibition about workforce planning. So people are more likely, right, to say, OK, this is what we need to do, and these are the plans that we need to make. People are more likely to fill posts on a permanent long-term basis if that degree of certainty is there.
I should have said this when I was speaking before. We've also got, you know, a long history of where we have used the workforce planning to train the workforce of the future. So when the 1140 hours for early learning childcare was brought in, we went through a programme, and this happened across the country, where we supported staff in other areas of the council workforce to retrain to work in an early learning environment. And in Glasgow, we also, a few years ago, were really struggling with teachers, so we created a team to programme to support staff to retrain as teachers, where they were first of all given 6 months where they could take a day a week to spend it in a school so that they could be sure that they were comfortable working in that environment. And then while they did a teacher training year, we provided them with a bursary to provide them with a salary while they were doing that training, on the basis that they would come back and work for us after that. So again, we use our workforce planning to try to plan those future gaps in our workforce.
Great, thanks very much for that. And Robert, in a previous answer, you mentioned these heat maps for your workforce planning. That seems like something that's quite an interesting process. Is that something that all councils do?
I don't know how the different councils go about it. I'm happy to share with the committee an example of the work that we've been doing. I imagine other councils are looking at specific areas to see where challenges might arise in the future.
Yeah, that would be great to see. Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, convener. Morning. First question I was going to ask was just following up on the the question I asked the previous panel around about trying to get some insight on the macro numbers. But then I'd quite like to move on quickly and explore some of the stuff that Robert was talking about on continuous improvement, opportunities for innovation, etc. So I don't know if you can cast any light on that. Would be helpful. Thanks.
Yeah. And obviously we had the benefit of hearing the previous answer. So I think the significant underlying trend is a significant reduction in the workforce over a number of years. But absolutely understand your question, because the numbers have increased over the last 8 to 10 years. That ties in with the increase in early learning and childcare resources, so going from almost doubling the number of hours that are provided, significantly increasing the workforce, leading to us to retrain staff to support that. Also within that timescale with the rollout of free school meals, which has increased the uptake of children attending free school meals. But perhaps one of the most subtle differences that was probably missed earlier was the classification of staff. So the figures you're quoting are council staff. They're excluding ALIOs. And in the period that we're talking about, a number of ALIOs have been brought back in-house. Most significantly, I think, in Glasgow, where Cordia would have been excluded from those figures. I can't remember the exact total workforce from Cordia. But I know that just on catering and cleaning, because they're now under my responsibility in Glasgow, I've got 3,500 staff that previously wouldn't have been included. I think when you add in the social care staff, you're probably talking up towards 10,000 staff. So that, just in Glasgow now, there's been similar moves in a number of other authorities where ALIOs have been brought back in-house. So I think that may be a significant element of that number, that when you add it onto the early learning and childcare and the free school meals would more than account for that increase.
Actually helpful. Thanks very much. I knew there must have been something there. So, I don't know, as an ask, yourselves or colleagues can perhaps come back to the committee with some more granularity on some of that, if you're able to put some numbers around about either those policy changes or the reclassification changes, just so as we can fill out the thing here. Because my next question was going to be, why is Dundee down 2%, South Lanarkshire's up 5% and Glasgow's up 28%, but you've answered that question already. Reclassification of ALIOs, which of course is I wasn't aware that they weren't included. So thanks very much for that. I think what I'd like to do is explore a wee bit further, as I said, some of the points Robert was making round about opportunities for improvement, removal of duplication, collaboration between councils on back office services, duplication with the wider public sector, including, frankly, with government directorates, is there overlapping duplication there, or with other agencies? What's happening in that space? And are you comfortable that we've got robust enough mechanisms to be able to share best practice and collaborate and understand and drive that as a kind of way of working, rather than something we do exceptionally under pressure? Who wants to go first?
Well, I start. Sorry,
please share, Robert. When you go, thanks.
Yeah, apologies. So I think this is an area that we haven't yet done enough on in terms of looking at how we can collaborate. So, and I know that, I don't know whether you've seen it or not, Solace have produced a piece of work. That's the local authority chief executives looking at what a future council might look like and how it might work. And we in Dundee, for example, are looking with our neighbours at what we might do differently and how we might share services. Some of it's driven by necessity and difficulty recruiting, and some of it's driven by trying to identify opportunities to make sure that we're not we're as efficient as possible with our support services. So, for example, one thing that we do at the moment now is to share a chief internal auditor with our neighbouring colleagues in Angus Council. I think there's still further things that we can do. We should be thinking about whether services are provided locally or nationally. And I suppose if you look at the number of bodies we've got, and Martin was talking about ALIOs, what's the most effective and efficient way of delivering different services? And councils are very much located in their place. So we generally have a good oversight about what's happening in a particular place. And I suppose that's where our focus should be, around how are we improving things for Dundee in partnership or for anyone's local area. I'm not singling Dundee out for special treatment, but how are we thinking about the outcomes that we're achieving, and not just about the protecting the services and the structures and the individuals that we have at the moment?
Yeah,
There's lots of examples of where we do work with other councils to deliver services. So Robert mentioned that he shares a chief auditor with another council. Glasgow provides the internal audit service completely for Shetland Islands Council. We also provide the internal audit service for a number of other public bodies, so Scottish Canals and Loch Lomond National Park. We provide the internal audit service for that. Across lots of specialist areas, even more so. So we have a computer audit team within Glasgow, so we provide, on a kind of almost consultancy basis, support to other local authorities, predominantly in the west of Scotland, but sometimes wider. But, you know, there's a bit of a misnomer that shared services might be the answer to all the questions, all the problems. Shared services have been about for a long time and they've not really massively taken off anywhere from a truly cross-organisational function. They work best within an organisation and being as efficient as possible. So again, in Glasgow, we've got a customer business services centre, which is in effect a shared service centre within Glasgow, where we've looked to centralise services and processes as much as possible. But we actually learned as we go through that some services are actually most efficiently and effectively delivered locally. So we've actually transferred some staff back to, for example, education, where staff lose their kind of drive for working because actually they want to think that they work in a school in their community and they want to deliver to services for that school and not think that they work in a shared service centre. So it's getting the balance right between how we deliver services, but it's something we work on all the time because we've been driving efficiencies because efficiencies avoid cuts as much as we possibly can.
Thanks, Chair. And if I can come in, probably most councils across Scotland will be able to provide examples of joint working. I do think it's more widespread than the sort of general consciousness would have you believe. For example, my own local authority, as well as providing back office services for ALIOs in our area, we've got CEMIS, which is the joint education system provider for Scotland, which now provides education IT admin services for all 32 councils. And again, for them, I'm providing the professional services backup. So these relationships and these things exist. As well as shared services, a term I'd probably like to use is joint working. Right? So a really good example of that in the Glasgow area is Glasgow City Region and the joint working around the city deal. Right? So you've got sitting behind which is on the face of it, a massive economic investment funded by the councils, the Scottish Government, the UK Government. You have services underpinning that, for example, a joint project management office, right, which is existing and providing those services to all the councils that are involved so that that's not duplicated within individual authorities. And you've also got an economic information service that's there as well, which is assisting all those authorities in progressing with the aims of the city deal. So those things are there, and that's helping to deliver a project that's leveraging in literally billions of pounds to that area.
No, I'm aware of the work that's happening there. So it's good to see that. And the point you make, Martin, about, very often decentralisation is actually more efficient than centralisation, not least because you can get rid of an expensive corporate function that may not be adding as much value as you think it is. So I totally appreciate that. I suppose just the question was, are you comfortable that there are mechanisms in place to facilitate that sharing? I suppose I'm thinking there about the improvement service and other work that's happening, but do you feel comfortable that that is part of the daily conversation and there's mechanisms to give effect to it?
So I think we're very fortunate in Scotland in the 32 councils. They do all talk to each other. They talk through the Director of Finance section. They talk through SPDS. They talk through ADES. They talk through SOLAS. So there's a structure there where we do all talk and we share good practice, we share experience across the board, and I think that happens in all kind of service areas. So I think we have a big advantage maybe over other areas where the 32 is not too big a number for that to work effectively.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. And now I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thanks for joining us today. We've heard a lot about changes which the pandemic has brought forward. And I wanted to ask with regards to how local governments measuring staff wellbeing around that and potentially individuals who are now permanently working at home, or what opportunities that's opened up for the workforce. So maybe bringing yourself, Paul, to start.
I think it's brought different challenges. And again, I'm not drawing on my own authority for this. This is something that I've had a discussion on over the past week. There is a belief, a view, that this is actually more taxing on younger, newer employees, right? Because you don't have that foundation of understanding a workplace environment, of having formed relationships. So, you know, I heard about one employer which actually asked their new intake of employees to try and work as best they could more from the office in terms of the majority for the first 2 years before, you know, if it was appropriate for the type of job they started working on a more hybrid or home working basis. So these things are appreciated as being difficult. Hybrid working has opened up new opportunities. So there are areas of staff who have become more marketable, right, because they can work remotely. I know of a procurement officer that we had who was working from his home in Lanarkshire with a London borough, right? So, and that was valued by that employer because it's really, really hard to get that resource. Now, that impacts on us because it makes it obviously harder to attract those people in as well, because they've got a greater degree of coverage that they can work to. One of the things that we did try to do as a council, and this is going back to August 2022, was put a paper to council, and it gets recognition in the local government overview report. There's a link in that to the report that we did, which was about a new deal for employees. And one of the things that was within that was about a right to disconnect. And I think we were the first authority in Scotland to do it. So what it was about was, it was a policy that said, look, these are your rights as an employee. These are your duties as a manager. And wherever possible, right, you should look only to be referencing, checking, answering email correspondence within working hours, right? Put that in the consciousness of everybody within the organisation. You've got a right to turn off, because it was becoming a factor, right, in people's working lives. So other things within that New Deal for Employees paper, as I say, it covered this right to disconnect. It did look at certain aspects around paternity, support for pregnancy and loss, and neonatal leave. And it was a package of measures, not with a particularly high cost, which was worked through with the trade unions, which took into account those additional pressures that had come about through hybrid working, through the pandemic, and tried to give something back to the employees in that respect. So that's just an example of us doing that as a council, but you'll see things like that across Scotland.
That's helpful. Martin or Robert, is there anything you want to add?
Yeah, again, would agree with Paul's comments that it does bring benefits through flexibility and making it easier to manage a work-life balance, but I think there's also significant downsides to hybrid working or home working that we just need to be very cautious about. Paul mentioned the thing about training, and you know, we all learn all the time, and we learn from each other, and we don't learn as much when we're not sitting next to that person. But just from a mental health, I think I'm concerned about people that aren't engaging enough with other people and the impact on their mental health. I know at the start, when everybody was working from home, and I was no different, and then actually we were getting work done in the house, and it was too noisy, so I came into the office as soon as I was allowed to come into the office, and came back in full time. And it was only when I came back in I realised how important it was to separate work and home. So I work in the office 100% of the time, because actually my commute, which isn't very long, in and out of work is where I kind of switch on and switch off. So I think from a mental health point of view, encouraging people to come into the office at least a significant proportion of the time is really important. That doesn't mean for everybody, and everybody will be different, but we need to make sure that we don't create future problems for our workforce.
Thanks for that. And Robert, did you want to come in?
Nothing to add. I think I would echo what colleagues have said. I suppose the support that we're putting in place for wellbeing is probably all a key component. So we're working closely with colleagues in the unions to actually make sure that support is in place. What we have found is that for some people it has been a challenge coming back to the workplace after COVID, and we need to put in different measures and look at different ways of doing it going forward.
That's helpful. And in terms of changes which we're seeing to services, what work's being undertaken to look at how these are disproportionately potentially negatively impacting on women and minority groups within the workforce? Is there any work taking place around that within your councils?
Maybe just generalise this a wee bit. One thing we would always look to do, and we've talked earlier on today about the financial challenges that face local authorities and some of the adjustments that will need to be made to services in order to try and close budget gaps and cope with that. So I use expressions like closing budget gaps. In large part, what that's going to mean are jobs being lost, right? And you know, again, we've talked about no redundancy commitments, and we would always try to redeploy people within the workforce. What we do, right, this will apply across all councils, is when we're looking at these measures, we undertake things like equalities impact assessments. And part of that will look at the impact on the workforce, and there'll be conversations with the trade unions. Again, the extent to which a predominantly female workforce, and I said earlier on, more than three quarters of the workforce is female. The extent to which I can protect women in the workplace from that, right, is going to be limited. But we would always try and make sure that's a consideration when we're undertaking change within services.
Okay, thanks.
Brilliant. And I suppose tying it back to the last question as well, what we should remember is the vast majority of our workforce can't work from hybrid working. You can't be a care worker and work from home. You can't be a teacher and work from home. You can't be a refuse collector and work from home. The vast majority of our staff are frontline delivery staff, and if they're not working, then the work's not being done. So for the vast majority of our staff, that doesn't apply. And as Paul said, applying our equality impact assessment to any changes we make is vital to make sure that we do things as fairly and equitably as possible.
And I just wanted to return just finally to Willie Coffey's question with regards to equal pay. We've seen the situation in Birmingham, and I wanted to ask if you're aware of situations in Scotland, councils who are still to settle that longer-term equal pay claims, and which councils potentially are exposed to that, and any concerns which have been raised with government around that.
I think in a public forum we'd be very ill-advised to talk about any individual councils for things that may well become legal cases. Again, difficult to speak about Birmingham, but you know, Glasgow's the authority of an equivalent size. We've worked through that process. The important thing, from my understanding, the issue that Birmingham had was they'd settled equal pay several years ago, but they hadn't fully implemented an appropriate pay and grading system and structure to protect themselves from future claims. And when I was answering Mr. Coffey's question, I was very clear that, and it is very challenging, but our job evaluation and the new pay and grading system that we're working through hand in hand with our trade union colleagues just now is vital for us to be able to limit that future liability.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. Something that came up very briefly in the previous panel, and I think it's connected to maybe to well-being but also recruitment, was the idea of a four-day work week. Is that something that is being considered, explored? Martin?
It's certainly something that's been talked about a lot in council chambers. I probably should declare this is my personal view and not the view of any local authority or any organisation. But going back to my answer to the last question, with the vast majority of our workforce are front-facing, they're client-facing staff. So if they go down to a four-day work week, then somebody else has to work that fifth day. So there is a 20% increase in the costs of delivering that service. We can't afford what we've got just now. So to put 20% onto our pay bill is not deliverable. And actually, the more there's talk of, you know, other workforces going to a four-day working week and the pressures that that will create, it will lead to massive inequalities in our workforce. So I'm not supportive of it in any way whatsoever.
Thanks very much.
As a personal statement.
Thank you very much. Thanks for qualifying that. Anybody else want to add to that? Robert?
If I may, just to say, I think within local government, we already have a very flexible approach to working. So we have, you know, certainly within my council, we have people working compressed hours. We have people working flexible arrangements, reduced hours. And I would have, my own view is that as organisations in local government, we're good employers in terms of responding to the needs of individual employees. So that all exists. But I would personally support Martin's view that given we're providing services in many cases 7 days a week, but often 5 days a week on a frontline basis, then trying to map that to a four-day working week becomes very challenging. And also we need people to be available to work when the services need to be provided. So if you think about the hours that a school operates, you can't do extra hours on a school day to facilitate it. So I think there might be some pockets of services where it could work, but by and large, I think there's probably other priorities for us.
Thanks very much. Okay, so that concludes our questions. And really, thank you very much for your evidence today. It's been insightful to get your perspectives. And I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you. and final panel this morning. We are joined in the room by Mo Baines, who's the Chief Executive of APSE, and Councillor Lynn Short, who's the Chair. We're also joined by Jerry Corns, who's the Portfolio Holder for Workforce Issues at Solus, and Fiona Whittaker, who's the Chief Officer of People Resources at North Lanarkshire Council. And before we go to questions, I'd like to invite Councillor Lynn Short to give a declaration of employment.
So I'm employed by Joe Fitzpatrick MSP for 7 hours a week. So I just wanted to declare that at this point.
Thank you very much. So we're going to start. I'm going to start with the general question that I've been asking at the beginning, and that's just to hear from your perspectives what you think the main challenges are for local government workforce at the moment. And I didn't say who to start with, but maybe I'll start with Fiona.
I'm going to try not too much to repeat what my colleagues have said, but obviously very much support what they've said. There are probably three points I think that I want to make that are most important, certainly from my perspective and my role, and also representing my colleagues in HR across the 32 local authorities. One of the significant things it's really important to bear in mind is that we're operating, and I think my colleague Paul Manning referred to this, we're operating in a very, very difficult labour market. So the actual availability of workforce is significantly less than it was prior to the pandemic. If I give you some numbers, certainly in my own area, that illustrate that, you heard the reduction in the number of unemployment, or the levels of unemployment. In North Lanarkshire, that's dropped from a kind of average of sort of 10, 11, 12,000 down to about 6,000. So it's now actually sitting at the lowest level that it's been in 10 years. If you add to that then the increases in economic inactivity that we're seeing, and certainly in my own area, that's a jump of 10%, what you're getting is an impact at both ends. So the actual workforce availability is shrinking quite significantly. So I just want to say that's one of the key things that I want to say. I think if you add to that, it's important to differentiate between the majority of workforces in local government, which are bottom-end workforces, frontline workforces, workforces that you've heard my colleagues talk a lot about that are very critical to us. And by and large, we recruit those workforces locally. So I'd like to sort of emphasise that link between that local labour market and the availability of that workforce, particularly in areas where we recruit from that kind of female 50-something population. That is the population we've seen the biggest increase in economic inactivity in. So those two things link together significantly. If I talk about the other aspects of local government workforce, so those senior professionals you've heard a number of my colleagues say are difficult to attract. The compression in our pay spine through sort of bottom-ended pay awards has significantly impacted some of those roles in terms of their standing in the, you know, in the actual labour market. Additionally, we've seen private sector organisations who've got more flexibility in what they do around their pay start to sort of inflate their pay to be able to attract those individuals across to those organisations. So that underpins a lot of the difficulty we have in both attracting and retaining the likes of accountants, you know, lawyers, architects, significantly impacts us. I think the last point I want to pick up, and I think my colleague Paul Manning talked about this, and the innovation and the answer, I think, lies in some of this, and that's the ability of local government to access skills funding. So things like apprentices and graduate apprentices are absolutely critical for us. As it stands, we don't have the funding to be able to support the development of particular workforce areas through our normal revenue funding. So access to those sources of funding that come through the levy are absolutely critical for us. So I'll give you a very brief example, and then I'll stop and let my colleagues obviously come in. So for social workers, critical, absolutely critical for us in an area of significant shortage across Scotland. As it stands, we're only able to fund, certainly in my own authority, about 6 places on a trainee scheme. Were a graduate apprenticeship to be available in social work for us, we could significantly increase the number of social workers that we would be able to train locally. And it is important that we train them locally because a lot of their practice is done locally, so we must recruit them into local authorities and then put them through their training and their qualifications. So I'll stop there, but just to illustrate, there are three key points for me that have already been touched on, but hopefully I've given you a bit more information.
Yeah. Thanks very much. And it's very helpful to get that level of detail. We start to get, helps give us a greater picture. Anyone else want to come in on that? Mo?
Thank you, Convener. Very similar to Fiona, APSE regularly surveys our member authorities to find out what it is that, you know, is creating the issues for them. Our latest workforce survey finds that 76% of our member authorities within Scotland cite pay as the main factor both in recruitment and retention of staff. There is some good news in that for Scottish local government. It's 82% on a UK-wide basis, so it's marginally less of a factor here, but nonetheless a huge issue. APSE's Local Government Commission also explored this matter, and I know Mr Cuffey referred to that earlier. One of the main things that came through the expert witnesses to our commission was a distinct lack of comprehensive workforce planning in local authorities. And again, that was on a UK-wide basis, but in part that does consistently cite the inability to plan long-term for the workforce because of the short-term nature of local government finance. So those two things are absolutely interconnected. And both before the pandemic and after the pandemic, we're seeing demand increasing on services. You know, accepting Mr McKee's questionings around those workforce numbers, underlying that is actually demand-side increases. We're seeing an increase in child poverty issues, an increase in the old population and therefore adults in need of more complex care. So the whole host of factors, the green economy, you know, local authorities are doing fantastic work in striving to get to net zero, but there are new skills needed, you know, construction, how to put solar panels on properties. Those skills lag behind. So the demand base for local authorities has shifted very significantly over, I would say, the last decade. And that we see as one of the main factors in terms of those workforce issues.
Thanks very much. And Gerry, did you want to come in?
Chair, and I'll try not to repeat comments or points that colleagues have made, but yes. I think the financial challenges that council face, our workforce are aware of those as well. And with that comes a level of uncertainty and perhaps anxiousness. And also comes with a level of change that's necessary in councils as they look to respond to these financial challenges. As Mo has mentioned, demand is not reducing, but we have problems or difficulties and challenges with resources, whether that's because of the labour market issues that Fiona mentioned. So demand increasing and diminishing resources, particularly in those areas where perhaps the fiscal framework and the budget settlements don't protect as much as others. We are still dealing with post-pandemic issues as we move from the kind of response phase into the recovery phase. That recovery is not overnight, and it's a recovery that our workforce need to go through as well, given the challenges that they face through the pandemic. So we are still dealing with that. But in that post-pandemic recovery phase, the challenges of new ways of working, and I know there were questions, and we'll probably come on to that in relation to the impact of hybrid working and the opportunities, but also the challenges that brings. And also, I think I've heard the panel discuss earlier, post-pandemic, some of that skill loss at perhaps more senior levels as well is bringing some challenges. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much for that. So I asked previously about the new deal with local government, which actually includes the agreement of working, also the fiscal framework and the programme of activities. And maybe if I come to APSE first, I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are in how this new deal can support the local authorities in addressing the challenges that they face in terms of workforce.
I guess one of the things that we have to be careful is we can look for the new deal, but we also, as local authorities and councillors, have to also be in a position to be the grown-up in the building. You know, at the moment we can say, oh, well, that's just because we've got that. I'm on the joint bridge at Joint Tay Road Bridge, and we don't have tolls, obviously, and there was a conversation about Transport Scotland, and I said, is there any questions about tolls, because that's a way of bringing in an income, and honestly, you'd think I'd said it's the end of the world. So we do have to make sure that if we are offered these opportunities, that we do take them up, and also think about what we're doing with our workforce beyond where we are at the moment. Those young people that we're teaching in those 1,140 years hours, they're actually the workforce of the future. Are we looking at AI? Are we looking on these heat maps about how we're going to deliver right across the board? So workforce is so incredibly important, but also is understanding what local authorities are going to have to deliver over the next number of years, and think about it generationally, because there's no point in just thinking about it now. My parents are in their 70s and they're still running around. In 6 years' time, I'm eligible for sheltered housing, which is, fills me with fear. But are we looking right across the board at what we need to serve for a post-war, post-baby boom generation that is becoming through now?
Very much for that. Anybody else want to come in? Jerry, and then Fiona.
I think at the highest level, the principles set out in the New Deal have got to be good for both national and local government. That earlier engagement and discussion about potential future policy initiatives, the implications of those initiatives and the implications for the workforce, and to support good workforce planning has got to be a step forward. And I think that earlier engagement will hopefully lead to kind of problem solving or solutions or understanding issues from the outset, rather than sometimes if that engagement takes place too late in the process, it feels as if you're almost putting barriers or hurdles because things have maybe progressed too far without a full understanding of those implications. So that earlier engagement and discussion round about these kind of things and the implications of new policy initiatives is going to be a good thing. And obviously a fiscal framework that supports that in terms of flexibility at a local level and how to deliver on those agreed national priorities is also quite a good thing, both of which have got to contribute to better workforce planning, because you'll have that longer-term view of what you need your workforce to do.
Thanks. Fiona, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, I would just echo what my colleague just said. For me, it's about, I guess, reiterating that you'll have heard my colleagues today say that we do understand where our workforce gaps are across the local authorities. You've heard us all collectively tell you what the known gaps are and also what some of the challenges are in actually addressing those gaps. It's not as simple as just going out there and recruiting people that simply don't exist. So for me, the New Deal, I think, will facilitate those conversations if we are certainly focused about the solutions that we can build locally. And one of the things I think we've touched on, but we haven't really talked about in any great deal, is the fact that local authorities have access to developing the young workforce. They have direct access to school children. So there are certainly lots of innovative programmes underway to try and engage younger people in some of the areas that we know are future gaps and build that future workforce. But where we need that national support, where we need Scottish Government to engage in solving some of the bigger problems we have, I guess one I would highlight is around engagement with the FE and HE sector. Certainly something that was very well set out in the Withers report, which was very welcome to local government in terms of that future direction and how we can engage in partnerships to solve some of these issues. So for me, that's a very important part of what that's about. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Mo, you want to come back in?
Yes, if I may, Convener. Thank you. I agree with all of the comments from colleagues on the panel. There's one element that I think we could turbocharge the New Deal with, and that's looking really seriously at a general power of competence for local government in Scotland. It's something that's been looked at on several occasions. I don't believe for one minute that the Scottish Government is taking a view of trying to hold back local authorities, but the current legal powers available to local authorities are being interpreted by the courts as opposed to by government and government will. So we have a nervousness in local authorities about how they can act in a more collaborative way, a nervousness about how they can act in a more collaborative way with partners in the private sector or other parts of the public sector. And actually some data we have going back to an analysis we did at 2018-19 on an area such as neighbourhood services and local authority parks, significantly less buoyant income in those areas.
councils that have been able to achieve additional resources through income generation are the very same councils that can then invest in their workforce using that income. This is profit for a purpose. It isn't profit to make casino bankers out of local authority chief executives. It's a sensible measure. So I think alongside the warm words in the New Deal, we could turbocharge that with some general power of competence for local authorities.
Great. Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with questions.
Thanks again, Convener, and good morning to everybody. I wonder if I could ask a question that I asked the first panel. It's really about how representative our workforce and local government is in terms of the communities that they represent. I don't feel that the first panel got really close to answering this particular question, but what's your own views, especially in senior positions in local government? How representative do you think that cohort, that group of people are of the communities that they actually represent day to day, and what could we do to try and rebalance it if that's an issue? Maybe start with Mo, if that's okay.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Yes, a very good question. And again, it was one we considered in our commission report. And what we found was the representative element of, you know, are you truly representative of local government, has to be asked on two levels. One is local councils themselves, are they reflective of communities? And in a party political system with different elements of selection processes, that can be very, very difficult to achieve. However, as employers with the workforce, it is possible to look at the demographics of the local area and look at how you are achieving that representation and looking outwards to communities to engage proactively in how you recruit people, because often there is a tendency, particularly in sort of professional level jobs, to go through the usual channels, which is, you know, a job advert in The Guardian. One of the things we recommended in our commission was actually an approach to grow your own. Put people on career pathways, have that talent spotting process, put people on career pathways, invest in training and development to change the structures and the face of senior leadership roles in local government. There is much more diversity in lower paid jobs, but that of itself is a problem. We are segregating people into low-paid work if by gender if you're a woman. We're segregating people into lower-paid work if you're from a BAME community, and that really is unacceptable in 2023. So we have to do much more to end job segregation in local authorities, but we also have to do much more to change the face of professionals within local authorities. I did an equalities review for a North West of England authority a couple of years ago. And amongst a senior management cohort that, you know, probably got to about 55 people, there were less than three BAME managers. And that was in an area where the local population would have reached around 6% of BAME communities in the local population, which was relatively low for that particular conurbation, but still not good enough. And one of the interviews with a member of staff who was looking after a group of activists among staff to try and embed change said, you know, how can we instill in people the ambition to become a senior manager when none of the senior management team look like I do? And that was a really powerful testament to that level of ambition that we need to reach in local government.
Well, thanks for that, Mo. Councillor Short, have you got a perspective on this as well? How representative is the workforce of the communities that they serve, do you think? You're Dundee, aren't you?
Yes, I'm Dundee, yeah. We've had quite a number of changes in our workforce recently, especially at the top end. And I think Robert's one of the few men that we actually have now in these positions. And it has been a lot of grow your own. We've come to the stage now when the sort of 16, 17-year-olds that went as YTS way back in the day, they're now the ones that are coming into these sort of medium to higher level management roles. And so it is reflective of Dundee, but likewise there are gaps within that, but you can't be it if you can't see it, as Mo was saying. And so we do have those opportunities to have seen leadership, and it is really important, especially now with hybrid working, that we do see our leaders, whether it's elected members or the actual officers.
Lynn, Fiona, Jerry, any perspective on how to make the workforce more representative of the communities they serve?
Sure, I can offer some things on that, Mr. Coffey. We have recently done a very powerful piece of work, I would say, but it was an elected member and officer working group that came to that conclusion that we needed to look very closely at representation in our own area, specifically around black and ethnic minority communities. So I would say that local government's pretty balanced in terms of male-female. But we know from that work, which was both within the local authority itself and also with the wider community supported by the University of West of Scotland, that we are not representative at any level. Our numbers of BAME employees are significantly low. But what we also know is that there are significant barriers to increasing that, and you do have to take very direct action and focused action, and that would include examples of what we're now starting to try, which is a blind recruitment process, a more inclusive recruitment process where you have better representation on panels. What I will say is all of that work has now culminated in my own local authority signing up to the recent work charter, which has a number of specific commitments that we now need to adhere to. So it's not easy. It's something you need to set out a plan to do and actually then change the systems and the processes that create the barriers, including unconscious bias, to change that. It's something we're doing actively, and I'm sure other authorities are beginning to consider that, because it certainly shows up in terms of people's experience of interacting with services. That's some of the other feedback we got in terms of language barriers and also just having to speak to somebody who's not from your own area about difficult issues that you're having in your life doesn't make it easy. So it's a commitment I think we could do much more on. It's something I think we need to accelerate. So
thanks, Fiona. Gerry, any other perspective on that?
I think colleagues have covered a lot of the main points. A couple of things I would maybe just say is, and one thing maybe taking a slightly different perspective, is in terms of the that representation of the communities that we serve. I think what's vitally important is that we can demonstrate that we have understood and we have interacted with our communities in terms of what they want. And I say want very specifically rather than need, because in the past we've had a tendency sometimes in local government to decide what communities needed rather than listen to what they tell us they wanted. So I think that's an element. Talking specifically about the employability issues, I think colleagues have made all of the relevant points. We clearly, as a local authority, we're looking to make sure we have absolute equality in terms of access and opportunity, but clearly we need to do more. And I think the national work that Fiona's talked about will feed into local work in terms of the practices that we need to look at and the areas that we need to improve.
Okay, thank you very much for that. My other question was on the gender pay gap issue that you may have heard in the other couple of sessions as well. Just to ask for your perspective on that. Is it improving? Is it still there? Is it worsening? Just what's your own experience? Maybe go back to Mo again and start there.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Again, going back to that issue of segregation of roles in local authorities, we can strive very hard to implement equal pay proofed pay and grading structures. We can strive very, very hard to ensure that pay to points relationships are robust and are job evaluated in a technical scheme, but we will still see a glut of predominantly part-time women workers who are stuck in low-paid professions. We need to break down the segregation between job roles. APSIS done a lot of work to encourage particularly women into construction through apprenticeship programmes. I have to say our member authorities in Scotland, again, are way, way ahead of other areas of the UK in terms of apprenticeship development and particularly apprenticeships in construction. But we need to go further and faster. I don't believe we can solve equal pay simply by having a technical approach to that pay-to-points relationship. We've got to look at the societal issues. And one area that we picked up on during the COVID pandemic, again, another APSI workforce survey on post-COVID return to work, was we found that there was a very genderised impact of COVID. Encouragement in some quarters that women could stay at home because actually it reduced childcare costs and they could manoeuvre their careers around childcare. So there's a big issue there around investment in professional childcare for working women. And again, that is something that hasn't been, in our view, sufficiently part of the discourse in terms of addressing those gender pay gaps. That, technically, we can look and say, some of those pay gaps are lessening, and that's a tribute to the work of our member local authorities in local government. But on the whole, that segregation of job roles is still a fundamental barrier to truly achieving equalities for women.
So, again, Councillor Short, any perspective from yours? Area on the gender pay gap issue, is it getting better? Are we getting closer to where we should be?
Hopefully I'm remembering right. Robert did say 1% in Dundee, didn't he? Compared to 3 at others. yeah, I agree wholeheartedly that it is a societal problem. When the early years came out, I was in the local paper saying this would be a great job for men. I'm a single parent. There's many single parents in Dundee. To have a man in that role just seemed to fit perfectly, that really early interaction. But there was, you know, streets of people saying, why would a man do that job? So we have to think very differently about the way that we talk about jobs. They're not gendered jobs, they're jobs, and people can bring different things to it and always look right across the whole spectrum of what that job brings.
Thanks, Councillor Short. Fiona Jerry, is there another dimension to this? Do we need to think more carefully about how we try to attract people into work and recognise the needs that they have themselves as people coming into the world of work? Do we need to adapt and be more flexible, do you think?
I think certainly occupational segregation is what you've heard talked about is a difficult issue to fix, and it is by far the biggest driver of your gender pay gap in local authorities is that occupational segregation. Some of it is about encouraging particularly younger males, I think, into some of these areas in terms of care, in terms of 1140s, where we know we're expanding the workforce. Equally, teaching is an area that probably could be better represented, both in terms of male and also in terms of BAME candidates. It's something I know that Education Scotland's currently looking at. The difficulty is that some of the choice that women make about those roles is actually aligned to choices that suit them from a personal and from a family point of view, and you've heard that alluded to. So I guess I'm not giving you the answer because it is a very difficult answer, but we could address that, I think, by the attraction of young males in particular into certain sectors. That certainly would help reduce the gap.
I think much of it's all been said. I think losing the thought of that idea of a male job or a female job is really important. I think ensuring that we've got workforce policies and practices that are positive and support all employees in the workforce, male and female, and don't provide or present any barriers for anybody in terms of workplace. Again, some of the things that we might come on to talk about, some of the opportunities we've got post-pandemic when we look at potential working practices and hybrid working, etc., is to make sure that we build in employee flexibility in that, employee preference and flexibility to encourage people to be able to continue in the workplace. And we can do that. I think we do now think differently about how we need to manage employees in terms of performance and not simply attendance and where they attend. So I think a lot of these things will help, but I think it's a huge challenge.
Thanks very much, Jerry. Thanks, everyone, for your responses to those questions. Thanks. Convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Pam Goosall.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. My question's around recruitment. We've heard today, and we know that vacancies are high, and Scottish councils fail to recruit workers for 1 in 4 jobs. And we've now heard from all 3 panels, including yourself, that one of the biggest challenges local government has is around basically funding. With these cuts lead to cutbacks on service provisions as well as strikes over pay and conditions. With lower pay and a job uncertainty, and with people choosing, we've heard, private sector more than local government, I wanted to ask around the question that basically what impact is this having on skills shortages and on local government's ability to deliver on the priorities? And just also when we talk about basically people seeing private sector more attractive, coming from a BAME background, I certainly know my parents that basically if I was an accountant, they would be pushing me into private sector more because of obviously the job security more than anything. I have worked in local government and I've loved it, I have to say, for under 20 years. So, but it's just on that to say that job security is a big thing with BAME, people from BAME backgrounds. I can certainly say that. I know we've been mentioning about BAME as well. So could I ask Fiona that question, please, first?
Sure, I fully agree. Our research underpins that the BAME families want their, particularly in the professional side, they want them to go into private sector. They're well educated. They want them to benefit from the background, the investment they've made in their education. And we found that in terms of whether local government's attractive or not to that sector. They tend to focus on areas like NHS and other professional areas, as you say, some of the big six consulting firms, the accountancy firms. But for us, I think it's more the pay issue than anything. Private sector, I think, do a much better job of selling that to a candidate in terms of that bottom line pay. What local government don't do, and we probably could do better, is that when you actually look at the total package that someone has offered, so I'll kind of stray into pensions territory, in the sense that pension contributions in local government are significantly higher than they are in private sector. So for a certain level or someone at a certain point in their career, it's actually really attractive to come across to local government. We don't sell that. What's more difficult is for younger staff who aren't really interested in paying a pension in the first place at the beginning of their career. So they're not interested in that money coming off their salary at the end of the week, as we know. But certainly we don't sell enough about those benefits of flexibility, the pension contributions, and just your own experience. It's a great place to work. It's very diverse. It's very dynamic. We could do a much better job, I think, of selling that to people.
Councillor Scott, do you want to say?
It's okay. It's safe to say, we've just come back from a seminar in Belfast, and it was local authorities from across the whole of the Four Nations, and Cinderella service was ringing out again and again. I think sometimes there's a little bit of an underestimation of what councils do for you, therefore it's difficult to attract people in. The amount of people that are on the phone about the buses and complain about the buses, and we haven't been involved in the buses since 1987. So there's very much that we need to have that conversation about where the responsibility lies and what you can actually do and deliver to your local authorities. Because I've been doing this for 7 years now, and those 7 years have been a bit tough. Tomorrow I'm sitting with Robert and we're away to look at the next budget. But what we also do is we bring great joy to our communities because we're delivering some wonderful things and we're solving some incredible problems that need to be solved. So I think we just need to be a bit more gallus about actually talking up local authorities, because they are the solutions often to the problems that you will see in your mailboxes as well.
Do you like to say anything on that?
I think, first of all, your point about funding and the financial challenges that councils face and that having an impact on our ability to recruit is absolutely correct, both in terms of potential employees and their view of the security, but also in terms of local authorities, employers and their confidence to go and fill posts if there are concerns about budgets going forward. I smiled slightly when you were talking about people moving to the private sector for job security, because I'm going to give something away here that I've been in the local government that long when I started, that was because it was a secure job for life, and I think we can't offer that now, you're absolutely right, but what we should be talking about to people is how we can offer a career for life. It might be in different jobs, but you might be able to work with us as a local authority, or you will be able to work with us for a local authority for life. So I think there's an issue there for local government in terms of how we market ourselves, in terms of the types of roles you've got, the types of career opportunities it will have. You might not finish in the same role that you started, but that should be seen as a positive in terms of the range of jobs that we can offer. And we do need to market ourselves in terms of the flexibilities and the new ways of working that we've got, because I think that is something where we are competing with the private sector. And in the past, a local authority would have been seen as, fixed hours in an office, etc. And it's not like that in a local authority anymore. And we need to make sure that we're getting that message out there.
Yeah, no, thank you. Absolutely. Thank you. I started off as a trading stands officer, went on to economic development heading up. So you're right, there's so many opportunities and we need to sell it. What would you like to add in?
Just very briefly, because I think Councillor Short covered up his perspective perfectly there. We do not offer or sell enough the value-based proposition of a career in local government and the competition for jobs that comes through from our members, for filling jobs rather from our members. It isn't just the private sector, it's other areas of the public sector. We know that we lose chief executives, we lose accountants to the NHS. They are seen as better in the concept of the public. But I think in terms of the ageing workforce issue, we should be selling a value-based proposition to younger workers, not just school leavers, but people coming from a college, offering them career pathways. I've yet to meet a young person coming out of college and saying, I want to make loads of money from everybody. Young people nowadays tend to be really concerned about climate change. They're concerned about social value issues. They're concerned about giving something back to society. And I think local government ticks all of those boxes, but we're incredibly poor at selling that value-based proposition, particularly to younger people. So I think, you know, we have to take responsibility for that as a sector, and we have to sell ourselves better.
Okay, thanks very much. Yes, all right. Looking forward to how that comes about. I just wanted to pick up on the Accounts Commission, in their report, they highlighted the overall absence levels for non-teaching staff in 2021 to 22, that they were the highest on record. And I just would like to hear what your thoughts are around what are the key drivers of that increase and what could local authorities do to support staff to reduce the rates of absence. And maybe I'll start with Mo.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think the figure cited earlier was 12.5%. Whilst I took advantage of being at the back of the room and emailed to get some figures from APSIS Performance Network's data sets, which have been collected now for over 25 years. So I've looked at some of the figures and the average figures for our member authorities in Scotland across different services. There seems to be some inflation in those figures, and I think that possibly the calculation of those figures includes long-term absence. So an example for the committee, in cemeteries and crematoria services, the overall absence level is 11.2%. When you take out long-term absence, that comes in at 5.5%. In an area like catering, the all-service average for the UK is 12.5%. Within Scotland, it's just 4.67%. But that, again, excluding long-term absence, drops to 2.4%. So there are very differential figures for different services, and I think it's important that we don't hone in on a headline grabbing figure but actually understand the granular level detail for those absences. Part of the issue that local authorities, in our experience, you know, absence management can be done really, really well in terms of offering support for people, but also, you know, there is a little bit of a carrot and stick approach to good absence management. It's unfair on other staff if people are off and it's not justifiable, but equally, where it is justifiable, how do we support those workers to get them back into work? And unfortunately, we do come across delays in things like occupational health support, and of course, the impact of delays in the NHS has to be factored in. If somebody's waiting a procedure, you know, maybe a surgical intervention from the NHS, that will impact on the figures. And the cohort of local government in terms of relatively low pay amongst quite a big chunk of it means that they are not the people that can bypass the NHS and go and buy those treatments privately. So we will see a higher level of absence generally amongst lower paid workers, but I don't think we should lump everybody in the same category, and we need to take cognizance of longer term absences that need a separate management approach to short term absence.
Great, thank you. I really appreciate you getting those figures actually, because I think that is the piece that we've kind of uncovered a bit today, is that actually when you kind of parse things out, you start to get a bit more of a fuller picture of what's really going on. Does anyone else have anything else they'd like to add? Fiona?
I can give you a bit more detail on that, actually, which may be useful for the committee. I think it's important to understand the predominance of absences. So the figure I think you've given is 12.4. I understand that's usually it's days per employee, days per FTE, that figure, 12.4. And that will be the local government benchmarking framework, which is consistent, incidentally, across all local authorities. A lot of work put into to getting that right. If you actually break that down, it's about 70-20, so 70% long-term absence, 20%
short-term absence, which you've heard my colleague Mo illustrate. If you further break that down in terms of reasons, there are two main reasons that drive those long-term absences. The predominant one is mental health related. Now, we in my own authorities have begun to dig under that to try and understand if that's work-related or non-work-related, because it's important, obviously, for us to understand that. What we find is that in certain services it is work-related. Number of colleagues referred to areas like home care, where that just constant working, high levels of overtime, basically driven by staff shortages, do burn out staff for sure, and that is certainly an area of high absence that is very difficult at the moment to address. The other area is bone, muscle, joint. We find in some of our frontline services that are heavy going, that are out in all weathers, that are obviously doing sort of heavy lifting. The bone, muscle, joint is also a significant factor. And you've heard my colleague refer to the fact that accessing treatment at NHS post-pandemic is very, very difficult. So you're looking at knee operations, hip operations, and they mean that some of those longer-term absences are unnecessarily protracted. Work we're doing around mental health is to help managers engage with their staff. So when staff go off with mental health-related absences, it can sometimes be difficult to engage with them. So absolutely support that better processes, better mental health supports will help with addressing certainly those more complex mental health-related cases. So hopefully that gives you a bit more detail.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much. Gerry, did you want to come in? No?
I think, obviously, in those figures, I think you are seeing the impact of the pandemic and the post-pandemic period. I think Fiona's articulated that, particularly on our frontline staff and particularly on care staff, where the demands that they have faced during that period exacerbated where there were vacancies, but we still needed to provide these essential services, etc. So I think you're seeing some of the impact, or you are seeing the impact of that in these figures. I think what it makes it clear is it's really important from a council perspective that we have got a high-level resource targeted at wellbeing and employee support in terms of how we can encourage people to be able to come back to work. I think we like to talk about maximising attendance rather than managing absence and the negative connotations that that has. But there are big challenges in the workforce just now post-pandemic, and for the reasons that Fiona and colleagues have articulated, not always able to tap into the resources that you would want to in the kind of timely fashion that you would like to, etc. But I think you are absolutely seeing some of the longer-term impacts post-pandemic.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful to unpack that piece a bit more and get that detail. I'd like to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks again, Convener. It's to ask the same question asked the previous two panels about the ageing workforce issue. I mean, we heard that we've got an ageing workforce within local government, but we're also hearing that local government workers retire early, and the previous panellists tried to explain the dynamic of why that should be. Does it all of that imply that we need to do more to try and recruit younger people to come into the workforce to replace? I know it's difficult to do because you need experience in a huge number of posts in local government, but what's your own perspective in this, and what can do to try and turn that round? We'll start with Mo again, if that's okay.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Yes, absolutely. And one of the obvious, really obvious issue with the ageing workforce is that even when we have people retiring, it's just other people in the workforce who themselves are getting older. So there's a natural progression of an ageing workforce. Scotland, based on your official statistics, appears to be doing better again than elsewhere in the UK in terms of bringing younger people into local government. But I think there is an absolute necessity to preserve some of the skills. So what we've lost in local government, I'll give you an example of a parks manager I was speaking to last December at our Performance Network seminar. And he said they no longer have the skills to maintain bowling greens, bowling pitches, because actually the old park keepers that had that very specialist work have all left. And a couple of the guys had actually come back in their own time to teach some of the younger people, you know, how it needed to be done. But we lose those skills to pass on to the next generation. So I think there's a huge gap there, and managing retirements in a much more flexible way would be incredibly helpful to pass on some of those skills. But again, in terms of the skill shortages, Grow Your Own is a really good policy, but it's incredibly expensive because you're doubling up in time, in productive time, to train somebody up to eventually be able to do that job on their own two feet. So it's a very expensive approach. And for many authorities, it's a luxury they don't feel they've got, particularly in some of the neighbourhood services where it's been unequal misery in terms of the reductions in overall spending power in those services. So there's quite a difference emerging in some of those frontline service skills, and that's coming through from APSI's own data. So a grow your own approach in a, you know, in a ideal circumstances, but unfortunately it is expensive to do, and we do lack a workforce plan strategy that's pan-local government to achieve those aims.
Thanks, Mo. Councillor Short, any kind of perspective on it from Dundee again?
Well, our Bowling Greens are now growing fruit and veg and things, so they've gone. The municipal ones are beyond us, so I'm now tapping into the private ones. But seriously, that's part of the equation as well. We haven't had apprentice gardeners for a long time because now it's about cutting the grass as opposed to bowling greens and verges and all these various things. But the problem that we have is we have an expectation from a society who wants bowling greens, but then you have the young society that are thinking about climate change. And if we've got wildflower meadows, then we can get bees and it's much better for the climate. So we're almost at a tipping point where we don't have the skills. We have one expectation on one side and one on the other. And again, it's that thing about us having to be good communicators and grown-ups and just explaining, look, this is for the bairns, this is for our future, and it's not because we want to cut it, it's or not cut it, as the case may be, but it's about actually providing the services that are available within the pocket that we have, because ultimately that's what we're talking about here, isn't it?
Thanks very much, Lynn. I mean, Fiona, Jerry, if this age trend continues to creep up and up, despite retirals and so on that we're seeing, what on earth can we do then to try and peg this back?
I think there's a couple of things. My own personal view is very much about engaging young people. We do definitely find attitudes towards particular traditional local government roles, you know, sort of bin men, care, you know, that is a generational challenge. It definitely is a generational challenge. However, what we found recently works, rather than sort of advertising for these posts, we've actually found that offering work placements to young people that are leaving school has actually worked for us, particularly in the care sector. I think we surprised ourselves by bringing young people into care settings and were surprised how engaged they were and how prepared they were actually to do jobs we wouldn't have expected them to do. So there's something there. But I think just to say the other side of that is that the economic inactivity, I think we do have to work harder through our employability funding and our employability services and support particularly sort of older generation workers that might have come out of other sectors that are maybe not so secure. So we know that retail and other sectors like that are very quick to put people back onto the marketplace when business is tight. So we do have to do more, I think, to sort of convince people to come to local government in some of the roles we've got and the job security that comes with that. And I think they're the main areas we really need to focus on. It's not easy for us to replace. Oh, sorry, there was one final point I wanted to make. I think my colleague touched on it. I think we need to think about how we structure some of these jobs. It's a bit like going back to demarcation. If we can actually structure the jobs where perhaps they're doing one job in the morning and another job in the afternoon, it might be more attractive if we have community-based workers rather than park workers or bin men or grave diggers, which is, you know, that's the reality of local government. But we need to be a bit more innovative, I think, about how we structure some of those jobs in future to make them more attractive.
Thanks very much for that, Fiona. Jerry, finally, perspective from yourself.
So I think it's a really interesting point you make, and there you kind of see the kind of juxtaposition of the two points about an overall ageing workforce but early retirements. But I think the point was made that it's the overall workforce that is ageing, and we have an increase in early retirement and a percentage of that workforce. So I think you can have both. I suppose the thing for me is that people's perception might be that it would almost, in kind of past times, it would be a case of one out, one in, and you would have that stability. And that's just not the situation that we're in just now, because we're either struggling to replace some of the skills that we're losing, or indeed there isn't a confidence in councils or as a specific or deliberate strategic choice playing being made not to fill vacancies because of the financial challenges that we're in. So it's a little bit of a broken record here to answer the specific second part of your question, Mr. Coffey, is that a degree of kind of certainty about the longer-term financial environment would give local authorities confidence in terms of their workforce plans and their ability to recruit. The points that Fiona made, how we use technology and innovation where we're struggling to fill roles or resources, how we look creatively at the kind of jobs that we're offering, using that innovation and technology, thinking very much about really the workforce of the future, what skills they need to have and what functions we need them to perform, but it has to be flexible and it can't be the kind of silo roles that we've had in the past.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, everyone. That's really helpful, your feedback on that. Thank you. Convener?
Yeah, thanks, Willie. Yeah, that was very interesting there to hear some of that detail. I'm now going to bring in Pam Goosall.
Thank you, Chair. We've obviously heard of the disproportionate impact on overall reduction in local authority personnel has had on council departments, particularly departments like planning and building standards departments. And earlier on, we heard from Joanna, head of local government, also mentioning that there has been around 40% cuts to planning departments. Therefore, I wanted to ask, with upcoming pieces of legislation proposed by the SNP Green government, including the new build heat standards and the short-term lets licensing schemes, obviously, undoubtedly, this will lead to an influx of applications to such departments. And I wanted to ask the question to the panel that are these departments adequately staffed and resourced to deal with an increase of such workload? And what kind of adverse impacts would it have on other stakeholders? Gerry, do you want to go first on that?
Yeah, thanks. So I think probably going to start to sound a bit like a broken record here, but so if you think about it from a local authority perspective in terms of the operations and the services that we deliver, very much driven by national policy and local policy priorities and the financial framework within which they're operating. And I think you've heard before that if we're looking at areas of service that council deliver in education and in care, which within the fiscal framework that we're working in just now are protected, then there is going to be, just logically and by fact, a disproportionate impact on those remaining council services in terms of the level of savings or efficiency that they might have to find. What can we do about that? Well, what we have to do and what local authorities are doing is looking at innovative ways of working, new technologies that we can use in terms of where digital gives us flexibility in the way that we deliver these services and how we interface with customers, how we set up. So if you take things like planning and building standards, the fact that we can offer an appointment with a duty officer online to discuss a particular planning or building control issue, having flexibility in the support teams for these services where we can not have only economies of scale, but also economies of scale because there are common support functions for a number of these services. So we have to look at all of these things. But in saying all of that, that doesn't mean to say it's a panacea. There are huge challenges in these services where, as I say, they've looked to have to take on a disproportionate impact in terms of some of the financial positions that councils have found themselves in. These things are the things that we have to try and do to mitigate that impact. But there are no doubts that in certain areas, there has been areas where that's had an impact on performance, for example, and the customer experience.
Fiona, would you like to say?
Yeah, if I separate out the two policy areas, I think certainly the short-term lets is probably going to fall in a ring-fenced area, certainly in terms of housing. We are one of the largest local authorities in terms of our housing provision, and therefore that probably will be absorbed within that. As I say, it's a ring-fenced budget, so there's a little bit more flexibility in that housing area. What I would also say is that councils actually through the pandemic were very good at redeploying staff from other areas. Unfortunately, that means shelving work in a particular area that's not seen as statutory or not seen as key, but we were certainly very, very good at redeploying staff during that period of time. Indeed, we supported in a number of areas like the NHS, so vaccinations is a very good example. So we do have some capacity to absorb those kind of challenges. What I will, however, say is planning is a different, so that's why I want to separate out the two. Planning is a bit of a perfect storm at the moment. There certainly were historical reductions in planners, and that combined with the fact that we're now seeing very few places across Scotland for professional qualification of planners, and we know that's quite a long-term process to qualify planners. My understanding through my colleagues is there's a demand for something like 700 planners over the next 5 years in Scotland, but the number of places actually being offered at university to planners based in Scotland as opposed to international students. So if you look at the figures, it's heavily weighted towards international students, and therefore there's an undersupply of planners. So there's definitely work underway, I think, with some of the universities in the Glasgow City region to have that conversation about the number of planning places, but that's not a quick fix. And we'd be looking at things like graduate apprenticeships and taking people out of school and putting them into trainee positions. Planning is definitely an area that we need to come together to fix. So I'll be honest about that.
Councillor Short, would you like to say?
Yeah, similar. The private sector service unit gets its money and it's working within that envelope. So that's sort of looking at the short-term let side of it. What we do is locally we do have planning students. So they often come in on internships during the process of their degrees. So that's an opportunity to almost have a summer of work where there's a chance to improve your CV, but also help deliver some of the work that needs to be done. We'd only got 26 square miles, so there's not much planning left. So we'll keep trying our very best. And building standards, you will know if there's slippage, because this Parliament, actually, I think it's one of the very few that come back to be graded, and you're given notice if you're not doing it properly and with value for money. So that's something presumably that you can check yourselves very quickly across all 32.
Thank you very much for the question. Many of the points have been covered, but we have just launched with the Town and Country Planning Association a research report on planning and its ability to deliver on climate change. And unless we get planning right, we will not achieve net zero. And some of the ambitions in terms of looking at how we green future developments is absolutely critical if we're to achieve those ambitions. I would, however, say, very much agreeing with Fiona on this, there is not just a shortage within Scotland of planners, there is a UK-wide shortage. That was very clear from the TCPA research. I think universities should have an answer to this. There's been a complete lack of investment at the university level in planning-related disciplines. It became, a not particularly attractive option, so we have lost that. I would also say, in terms of that issue of funding and funding cuts, this is one of the areas where non-statutory related, not capped fees, but advisory work that could be done using a general power of competence, charging for those services, let developers pay a little bit more in order to generate some income into that and hopefully improve the planning service. There's been case law in the past around, planning and planning charges and how far local authorities can push the parameters on that. I think this is an area where we should be looking at a greater degree of more commercial thinking in terms of what income could be achieved by providing salient and good quality professional advice that in turn would support the future of the service in terms of developing the planners of tomorrow.
Chair, do I have time to ask a quick follow-up? Is that okay?
Sorry. Quick, right, okay. Right. Okay, that's fine, yes, sorry. We've heard from, obviously, the other panels that councils aren't equipped to deal with increased workload that new legislations bring. To look for a solution, do you think that basically time is a factor, that if you were given a lot more time when legislations are coming forward, for example, to plan your apprenticeships, internships and things like that? Gerry, can I ask you?
Time would be a factor, and I think I said that in an earlier response round about the New Deal Inverted House Agreement, that would be a positive in that if there was earlier awareness of policy developments. But broken record, that's going to come back to sufficient resource to deliver it as well.
Thank you.
Okay, great, thanks. I'm now going to bring in Ivan McKee, and time is really ticking on, so.
Thank you.
The area I want to focus on, no surprise, you've heard my previous comments, leave the workforce stuff, because I think I've got a bit more sense on that now, but it's about the process improvement, the innovation. If you look at the Audit Commission report, there was talk in there about, during the COVID period, agility, ability to work across boundaries, etc., and we'll experience that was much more prevalent than previously, or sadly since then. So bearing that in mind, it'd be good to get us, and also clearly changes in demand, changes in policies. We've talked about what the future looks like in terms of workforces, is something that needs to be thought through, and taken on board the comments that have been made already about the lack of multi-year funding obviously impacting on that. So I suppose the questions are, number one, in terms of mechanisms to support innovation, do you feel that's strong enough and embedded enough in that culture of looking for opportunities to improve is there? And then number two, looking to the future, what kind of work is going on to try and understand what local authority of the future and the workforce plan of the future could look like? And just to throw in, I'm very interested more in this general power of competence, so you might want to kind of touch on that in your answer and the scope that offers and what would need to happen to take that forward through legislation or other mechanisms. So I'll just throw that out there and let you answer as you see fit.
Take this first.
On you go.
Thank you. In terms of innovation, I don't think there's any lack of ambition amongst our member local authorities. As Councillor Short mentioned last week, we were in Belfast. There was over 250 representatives of local authorities there, and the whole event was around sharing innovation and best practice. I don't think there's a lack of ambition amongst local authorities, but they are hidebound by the resources that they have. And particularly for APSI, our concentration is unashamedly on frontline services. And what's happened to the way in which those resources are distributed is the protection of statutory services in terms of education, in terms of social care, has meant that there has been this very unequal and lumpy settlement in terms of neighbourhood services. So the services that people see when they step out of their front door are the very services that actually have been hit hardest through the era of austerity and beyond. So for those services, their workforce planning looks very, very different, because what they've had to do is crisis manage reductions in staffing, crisis manage some of the skill shortages in those areas. They are now lifting their heads up above the parapet a bit more and saying, what can we do differently? So there's open discussions there about environmental apprenticeships. There's open discussions around looking at green skills and can people move between departments, but also now move between authorities to pick up skills. So things like being able to maintain EV assets, fleet assets, or maintain hydrogen. Those are new skills that will come forward. So workforce planning, in APSI's view and based on our research, has got to address not where we're at now with local government, but looking in 5 years' time, what will the skills be that we need to meet? In terms of where that ties into this general power of competence, I think looking at some of our data, the buoyancy of income generation for some areas of neighbourhood services has been stymied by a fear that if they do things that they then push the boundary, they're acting in an ultra-vires way, will they be open to challenge? So the purpose of a general power of competence is to really give people a power of first resort. It does not prevent Scottish Government saying to councils, you know, this is not a backward power where you can, you know, start doing things that we've previously debarred. Charging for collection of domestic waste would be an obvious one. It's not allowing councils to suddenly generate new taxes and charge for things that we've not previously charged for. But it does allow innovation, and it does allow better cooperation and coordination across local authority boundaries. It's not limited to the concept of well-being. It says, basically, if you or I can go out and do something innovative, and we're not ripping people off and we're not putting people at risk, and it's done with due regard to health and safety, those are things that we can do. And part of our argument as APSI has been, please make sure that you talk to local businesses. This isn't about putting the local window cleaner out of a business or putting a local gardener out of a business. But let's look, where can we expand that innovation and actually get a little bit of income generation into local authorities to help meet that resource gap?
Can I Community wealth building is a huge opportunity for us. Yesterday evening, I had a meeting with one of the local builders, and they want to give back, and they do ground maintenance and things, and they were talking about looking and working with the communities. And very often, I have to put my hand up and say, what am I for? Because an IGB will make a decision, 29 will make a decision. It's very much sometimes quite far from where actually things are delivered on the ground. And so oftentimes it's about really being at that very community level. And at community level have PB, empowerment monies and things, but oftentimes they don't know how to use them. So I'm that person that can link in the builder to create that nicer community environment that doesn't have to involve the council, so we can maybe step away sometimes from that thing that the council doesn't have to be your mum. They don't have to do everything for you, and actually sometimes communities know what they want. I recently worked with the police, and a piece of ground that the council used to cut actually belonged to the police, but the police gave us permission to work with the Eden project, and now we have a wild meadow and it's next to a school, and the school are going to look after the wild meadow. So these are the things that we should be thinking about and doing, and using the local members to be that conduit to make it happen.
Absolutely. Good. Thank you. Fiona?
I would just echo what my finance colleague said earlier. There's certainly a huge opportunity in local government for digitisation to make a difference. Certainly, I, prior to joining local government, worked in private sector, so I know there's definitely opportunity to strip out complexity, to be more efficient, to be more productive. And I think the majority, I'll leave my colleague Jerry Corns to pick that up, the majority of chief execs and councils have some form of digital programme, so they're certainly very, very committed to that area. I think also thinking about co-locating services as well, there's lots of discussions, I think, in a lot of local authorities about a review of their assets, their buildings, and whether they can be, as they replace some of those buildings, whether there's opportunities for co-location with colleagues in health and colleagues in other services. So, but, you know, better support for citizens in particular places, but also lower costs for councils in terms of assets and costs of running buildings, etc. So they would be two things I would probably say.
Thank you.
Thanks. I think Fiona's right. I think there won't be a local authority in the country that doesn't have a transformation team or a team that's based, basically looking at transformation and new and more efficient ways of trying to deliver services and improve performance as well, supported by initiatives like the Digital Office, which all 32 local authorities, and I think earlier in the session there was reference to the Improvement Service and the COSLA piece of work, which kind of looks at the workforce of the future, but looks much more than that in terms of how we engage with and support and deliver with our communities. Double win there in terms of it's better for communities and their community wealth building, but obviously better for local authorities as well if there's efficiencies that we can generate through working that way. So I guess that piece of work improvement service and COSLA are looking at is, what does that mean for our workforce of the future? What skills do they need, because it's very different from the skills that were required for a local authority employee when I came into local authorities. And thinking about, you know, that idea of shared services, well, there's been quite a number of attempts at that, and they've failed, I would say, or at least not been as successful as people would have wanted in the past. I think one of the things within that was that where a shared service is a more efficient option for a local authority, it doesn't actually always deliver for that local authority's communities, because in the past, shared services went, well, this group of employees can relocate over here and work in that area. Well, if you're a local authority who's shipping people out to work somewhere else, you're not actually supporting your own local communities. New technology and new ways of working mean that doesn't need to be the case, because we can work in this flexible digital way. And I think if we think more about how we share resources rather than thinking about sharing services, which tends to feel as if somebody wins and somebody loses, but actually if we share some common resources and collaborate, then we can certainly deliver improvements that way. I think the city regions are a pretty good example of that, where the programme management offices within city regions, the intelligence hubs, the work that we're doing collaboratively around about employability is a pretty good example of that, I would suggest.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ivan. We're now going to questions from Miles Briggs.
Uh,
Thank you, Convener. I think most of the points I wanted to raise have been covered, but I wanted to ask 2 points. Firstly, around changes to services going forward, what work was being undertaken to look, and I asked this in the previous question, at potential negative impacts, specifically on women and ethnic minorities in the workforce, and what forward planning is going on around that. Fiona, maybe bring you in on that.
Certainly, I think my colleagues talked about quality impact assessments are key, because obviously we have to make decisions around services and the reduction of those services if we're under significant financial pressure, which we are. Those sometimes do differentially impact on certain groups, whether it be community-based groups who make use of those services or indeed the staff that are within those services, and that would be predominantly an impact on women. We can't avoid that, I think, is what I would say, but what we can do is fully consider those decisions with a quality impact assessment and make sure we do full consultation before we go ahead and deliver it. So hopefully that answers your question.
Thanks. And to go back to some of the points we've heard today around workforce planning, specifically I'd written down graduate apprentice scheme for social care being asked for, around planning places to actually increase the number of planners. I had a meeting with Edinburgh College this week where they were talking about they had actually had 300 additional people wanting to do construction courses that they couldn't take. So I just wondered, in terms of the outcomes, and you mentioned the Withers report, why haven't we got to a place where public services, be it the further education institution or college sector, council sector, are linking in with that development of workforce? I'm sure it is, but it doesn't seem to be delivering the outcomes we've been talking about for years in terms of headcount and flow of new entrants, both to the college sector and then also into local government. So I just wondered where you, maybe to return to the Withers report, was it just dumped on a shelf? Or why haven't we seen that workforce planning linking up? It seems strange that we're still talking about some of these issues.
Is that all right? Yeah. Okay. So I think what's set out in the Withers report is excellent, I have to say. It is a really good report. It's very, very comprehensive. And I think the answers are within that report about the disconnect between the different entities that are operating in that space. What it means for councils is the same as what it means for other employers operating in that sector, including if you speak to the large construction firms, they'll tell you exactly the same. It's a complex landscape to navigate, both in terms of qualifications, and what's on offer doesn't join up. So what you can't do is bring children out of school and then put them onto a pathway, because the pathway isn't joined up in terms of qualifications, either availability, or there are gaps between the SCQF level or the SCQF provision within that. What is a really good example of where you can join it up, and I think it was referred to previously, is 1140ers. So we now have a pathway, and a number of local authorities have done exactly the same, where you can, the availability of those apprenticeships obviously was aligned to the Scottish Government's policy, but we can bring staff in at an entry level, I would call that, and that a lot of that is young people. And there is a career pathway all the way up to actually a graduate qualification, which allows you to run, for instance, a family learning centre, well-paid job, fully qualified job at SCQF level 9 or 11, I think it is, a degree level qualification. So those pathways are critical. We need more of them. It just takes time to get all the pieces of the puzzle lined up to be able to deliver that. That's the real challenge. So.
Just to add to that, we've done a lot of data work around the skills shortages, and the figures for Scotland are really quite stark. So 58% are reporting shortages of HGV drivers, 41% on all other drivers, in highways and street lighting 47%, construction is at 39%. So these are really stark figures of councils struggling to recruit, and the only way they will do that is if they bring in people at apprenticeship levels and train people themselves. The complaints from our member authorities is the mismatch in the courses on offer in traditional FE sector and certainly university sector. So it's not something that's that easily joined up. So one authority, and this was a member authority in Scotland who will remain nameless, but they were looking at training EV technicians, and they basically had to approach a private sector garage that would be able to, you know, they had some skilled people doing that to effectively develop their own course. It wasn't something that was on offer in a traditional, you know, mechanics training course at the local FE. So councils are being innovative in this area, but they really do struggle, that mismatch between what is on offer in current formal structures and what they need in terms of those frontline service skills.
Mo said it would remain nameless, but it was actually Dundee. So I'll just show off about that. What we also have to remember is within the young people that we're coming through now, we have the cohort that is the COVID generation. So we also have to make sure that we're preparing them even for going to do apprenticeships in colleges. I work on a board with young people, and it is purely a transition to trade opportunity. You know, we're in a cost of, some people call it living. For some of our communities, it's a cost of survival. So the last thing that you have on your mind is getting up in the morning and going to college. So this is about actually preparing young people through their second, third and fourth year to then go on to that next point. So we have to always look at maybe a report on a shelf, but also look at what's happening to the people that we want to take into these roles. It's very academic sometimes, but at the end of the day, it's communities, and we'll go back to the fact that we know our communities, so we can, you know, report back what's happening.
Thank you.
Point is when we were talking earlier about regional partnerships in the city region and the work that happens there, very careful consideration of the Withers report, as you'd anticipate, and ongoing work with higher education, further education, to identify the skills gap in the wider city region for all private businesses in terms of what's going to stimulate economic growth and economic regeneration. We need to make sure that local authorities are part of that consideration, because if we're not there to deliver some of these vital services, then you're not going to get that economic growth. And we need to make sure that the local authority consideration of where our skills gaps are is part of that wider regional work and that aim to stimulate economic growth. Thank you.
Ms. Camino.
Thanks very much, Miles. And so that concludes our questions. I think it's been yet another very rich panel. I think it's worked very well to have this progression and get the more detail from your perspectives. And so thanks so very much for coming in today to share your thoughts with us. And now we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next item in private. So as that was the last public item of the agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.